The first item of business is a debate on motion 2686 in the name of Hamza Yousaf on supporting and strengthening Scotland's island communities. Would all members who wish to speak in this debate please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Hamza Yousaf to speak to and move the motion. You have 14 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For a boy born and bred in Glasgow, I cannot claim to have an island heritage like some members in the Chamber. And while I would often say and have often said my heart truly belonged to Glasgow as a result of recent visits that I made across the islands in May and the summer months, Glasgow might just have to get used to sharing my heart with many of our islands. These visits to 18 of Scotland's islands, and many more, of course, to go, show the extent of the contribution our islands make to Scotland's cultural and economic well-being. That is known to many members across these chambers. I was delighted to be able to meet with some members during their visits to these islands. Kate Forbes on the island of on Skye and Rassie. I met Kenny Gibson, of course, on Arran, and Liam MacArthur, who was kind enough to give me a cup of tea and a biscuit in Orkney. That being said, he did then publicly go on to ask for millions of pounds for Orkney, Presiding Officer. It was the most expensive custard cream I've ever had. But nonetheless, of course.
Stuart Stevenson.
Is it not surely the case, Minister, that Glasgow has actually shown us the way as a city of the value of islands with the tradition of travelling doon the water?
Hamza Yousaf.
Yes, I was actually thinking he was going to come in the custard cream, so I'm somewhat disappointed by Stuart Stevenson's intervention. But yes, he is right, of course, to make that point about Glasgow's leading the way. In terms of Scotland's islands, they are key, of course, to maintaining and nurturing the health of Scotland's second language. They play host to a myriad of musical and cultural festivals, often born and supported by the local communities. They're home to 16 of our world-famous whiskey distilleries, and of course, they are the home of some of the most stunning scenery on these islands. Presiding Officer, it would be a very, very brave person who would have to pick out one of our islands as the most beautiful, so I certainly won't do that, but one of the highlights of my visit was a sun-kissed day in Rassie, just again demonstrating that tourism is so essential to our country, supported by our islands. That contribution and those interests have rightly been championed through the Our Islands, Our Future campaign, and I want to pay tribute to the three Holy Island Councils who led that campaign and who have led that campaign. We published our response empowering Scotland's island communities in 2014, setting out a comprehensive package of actions and measures to empower Scotland's island communities. Presiding Officer, I'm determined to ensure that the actions we take forward in this Parliament meet the needs and interests of all who grow up, live and work on Scotland's islands, as well as those, of course, who provide services and those who run businesses, again, many of them who I managed to visit during my island tours. That is why, as at the earliest opportunity, I prioritise meetings with constituency and list MSPs, with council leaders, and of course, as I have said, visited those islands directly myself and every single one of the six local authorities that have responsibility for island communities. I'm very keen to hear the contributions across the chamber this afternoon when it comes to the benefits, the opportunities, but of course also the challenges sometimes associated with island life. Of course.
Tavish Scott.
For giving me, and also for the tone of his remarks this afternoon. With his responsibilities for islands, would he take into account the public service requirements, particularly in relation to the health boards, where the GP vacancies that we're all facing across all of our areas are considerable? Could he outline in his remarks today what his government are going to do to address that specific issue? Because they are in many ways unique to the recruitment challenges of islands and indeed, in fairness, to the broader Highlands and Islands area.
Hamza Yousaf.
Yes, I think he makes the point very well, and he'll know our views on and I hope he's been given some level of assurance. I'll appreciate probably won't be enough assurance for him, but he's been given some level of assurance over the work we're doing in regards to health board reorganisation. But I think his point was actually well demonstrated to me when I went to Rassie, and there was a discussion, a robust discussion between the local community in Rassie and the health board between the out-of-hours nursing provision. So I'm well aware of what he says. I'll try to address the health board issue as well, and if not my opening remarks, and certainly my closing remarks, if I can. But he makes the point, and I think he makes it very well. I should say, when I went to Shetland, of course, the member was not there, didn't offer me a cup of tea or a biscuit, but that is one that is outstanding. Over the next year, this government will bring forward an islands bill, which I was delighted to be able to announce as a year one bill, reflecting a key commitment in empowering Scotland's island communities. And on the proposals we consulted on at the end of last year, again, many members contributed to that consultation. The bill will focus on island-proofing, a unique concept that will ensure that legislation passed in this Parliament doesn't detriment, but it hopefully adds benefit to our island communities. A national islands plan, statutory protection for the Western Isles Scottish parliamentary constituency boundary, flexibility to create one or two member wards for island communities, and the extension of powers focused primarily around the Zetland Orkney County Council Act of 1974. I intend to continue engaging with local authorities and communities throughout this bill process, Presiding Officer, to ensure that it stays focused on their needs and their interests. I'm even willing to consider the Japanese Remote Islands Development Act that David Stewart, MSP, raised with me at committee on Tuesday. I know other parties have had similar commitments to island bills, to island legislation, to island proofing, and their election manifestos, so I'm very keen to make this as a consensual as I possibly can process and piece of legislation that we can hopefully take forward together in this Parliament. This summer, I worked with local authorities to establish a newly created islands strategic group. And what I was very keen to do this time around was expand the membership previously made up the ministerial group of the three Holy Island Councils, understandably so in the formation of that group, but I chose to extend that group further to include representatives of Argyll and Bute, Highland Council and North Ayrshire. This group will help to shape the bill and indeed the National Islands Plan. I look forward to their guidance, excuse me, and their input. We've had one meeting already and the second one hopefully soon. Together, the bill, the plan and the strategic group will form a powerful triumvirate of actions which will help strengthen and support the unique needs and the interests of Scotland's island communities. I want to touch upon, if I can, Presiding Officer, on some of perhaps the challenges and the opportunities that I think our island communities face. One of the common threads through any island that I travelled, I think every single one of the islands that I travelled to talk to me about depopulation and the issue of migration. Growing the island's populations is, of course, crucial for island economies and community sustainability. Clearly, we need to give particularly young people and young families more reason to stay on islands. The presumption against closing rural schools helps, as does our investment in modern apprenticeships and work to cut youth unemployment, while investment in social housing through the Rural Housing Fund and the recently announced £5 million Islands Housing Fund will help to create more affordable homes. But we also need to ensure that migrants can continue to come to islands, to work in key sectors. I, during my islands visit, travelled to many, for example, a fish processing business that relied very heavily on that EU migration. But there were, of course, other industries such as hospitality, agriculture, and the care sector that relied heavily on migration. So we all know that, of course, migration currently is reserved to the UK government, but we'll continue to push the UK government for a migration system that meets all of Scotland's needs, including our island communities. When it comes to connectivity, clearly there's a reason why the island's brief and the responsibility is here with the Transport Ministry and the Transport remit. Connectivity is so important to our island. This government has made a clear commitment to our ferry services, investing a record £1 billion in port infrastructure, vessels and services since 2007. On my first day in post, the £900 million contract to operate ferry services on the west coast of Scotland was awarded of course, to CalMac and came into force on the 1st of October. We will maintain the road equivalent tariff on the West Coast, which has resulted in lower fares and increased passenger numbers. We've already begun to progress our commitment to reduce fares on ferry services to the Northern Isles. I will report on the findings from the recent consultation shortly. I consider it important to take forward a scheme which reflects the wishes of those who use these ferry services. We want to get the scheme right because there is not an easy answer in terms of finding an algorithm, a process, a mechanism which reduces ferry fares in the Northern Isles. In the same way, for example, you couldn't just replicate RET across the Northern Isles to the same effect because it might increase some of the ferry fares and some of the routes, but of course I'll give way.
Liam MacArthur.
grateful to the Minister for giving way, and like my colleague Tavish Scott, welcome the tone of much of what he said. While I appreciate he may not be able to provide the detail this afternoon, can he at least offer some reassurance that the scale of the reductions that we've seen on the West Coast will be replicated in terms of the reductions we can look forward to seeing on the Northern Isles routes?
Hamza Youssef.
This stage that we'd look to make a significant reduction. I mean, I think that's what the islands communities and those on islands would expect. Can I say it would be exactly the same as X island that is benefiting? Certainly not at this stage, but the member will know that I will be very keen to keep him and his colleague Tavish Scott up to date on those conversations. But of course, ferries are not the only way to connect to our island communities. Aviation and air services are also incredibly important. We're committed to continuing the air discount scheme through an investment of £8.5 million at the current 50% discount rate to make air travel to and from the islands more affordable. I also agreed at last meeting of the Islands Transport Forum the extension, and that we would consider the extension of the scheme to business travel. That will be considered following the autumn statement, and I want to thank the islands for putting together a proposal about how they think that could work. Sticking to the theme of connectivity, perhaps of a different kind, I know members across the chamber have been very, very active in putting forward questions on digital connectivity high up the agenda for those who live in islands. Again, probably one of those common themes, presiding officer, on almost every island that I visited was digital connectivity, arguably most important and the most remotest of islands in order to giving communities and businesses the potential to transform their island. We are determined to ensure that every premises in every part of Scotland has access to superfast broadband by 2021. It's fair to say that if it was left to commercial operators, there would be a severe lack of coverage in some places, no coverage whatsoever. Our digital Super Scotland superfast broadband programme is helping to make is helping to bring that connectivity where it wouldn't elsewhere be. Across the Highlands and Islands as a whole, at least 84% of premises will have access to fibre by the end of 2016. What we have to do is try to get ourselves into those most challenging and most remote islands. That will be most certainly the challenge. In terms of, and that I should say also, we also have considerable plans and taking forward plans for mobile phone connectivity as well, and working with the industry, so there's an industry-led approach to this. I also want to talk about, if I may, Presiding Officer, about energy and renewable energy and islands, wind projects in particular on our islands. Again, I was delighted to be able to see EMEC myself. I've heard about it in this chamber on many occasions. And again, a number of the islands I visited, ploughing a lot of investment and time, expertise and knowledge into renewable energy schemes. Rapid growth by the 2020s could result in economic benefit worth up to £725 million for local communities. We're doing all we can with the powers that we have. Members across the chamber will know about our community and renewables energy scheme, our CARE scheme. However, larger scale island projects need a route to market that recognises their distinct characteristics and addresses barriers to development. We came close to achieving this through the Scottish Islands Renewable Delivery Forum, with unprecedented cooperation involving the Scottish and UK government and, of course, the island stakeholders. But the UK government has now changed its earlier commitment to provide a minimum allocation for wave and tidal stream technologies. Its decision to consider withdrawing support for island wind is enormously frustrating and disappointing, coming at a crucial time for both marine and island wind projects. We'll continue to push the UK government and UK ministers to deliver the necessary support to our islands, the support that they need to realise their renewable potential. On top of that, there are issues, there are questions in relation to Brexit as well. That was mentioned to me during our ministerial group. It's a piece of work that I'll continue to do with local authorities, but it's fair to say that our island communities have benefited from that EU support, be it financial or otherwise, and so therefore I'm keen to work with them when the Scottish Government is involved in discussions with the UK Government and with the EU directly. If I may, in conclusion, just touch upon very quickly and very briefly a couple of points. The Crown Estate and the promise of devolution of powers over the Crown Estate is something that was made in manifestos across this chamber, including in our own, of course, going on the back of and following on from the Smith Commission agreement. We will continue to press the UK government to devolve those powers. Of course, discussions are ongoing with the transfer scheme as we speak, and this is of interest of all local authorities. The three Holy Island communities have approached me about the potential pilot. It's something I'm open-minded to, as is the Cabinet Secretary for the Environment. Fair to say there are some legislative obstacles that may come in the way. I see I'm over time, Presiding Officer, so I will just conclude by saying I'm very excited about the Year One Islands Bill, particularly the idea of island proofing. I know there's many questions that members have across the chamber, many contributions that will be made. I know there's some concerns around health boards. I know there's some concerns about what we're doing in regards to the Enterprise and Skills Review in Highlands and Islands, and I'll look to address those in my closing remarks if I can. But all I can say at this moment to conclude, Presiding Officer, is that I look forward to working with members across the chamber to deliver for our islands, and I think our islands communities would expect no less. There's an exciting future for the island communities.
You not must just, close, Minister.
Not just with this government, but I think from cooperation across this chamber. Thank you.
Could you move the motion, please?
Oh, yes. Motion in my name.
I now call on Donald Cameron to speak to and move Amendment 2686.2. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I guess I forget, I move the amendment in my name at the start rather than the end. For any MSP representing the Highlands and Islands, yesterday was bittersweet. Sweet insofar as we learnt the wonderful news that the smelter in Fort William is to be sold to a company which will not only maintain the smelter, but possibly expand it, securing existing jobs and potentially leading to increased employment in Lochaber. I apologise for digressing momentarily from the islands aspect of this motion, but given its importance to the region as a whole, I feel it only right to mention it briefly. I would also like to place on record my acknowledgement of the role that Fergus Ewing has played in achieving this outcome and offer my thanks to him for all his work behind the scenes. However, it was a bitter day too. Bitter because we learnt that the governing board of HIE is to be scrapped, and the new Scotland-wide agency will be overarching and replace existing agency boards. This is not mere administrative tinkering. It is the death knell for HIE as we know it, and it is nothing short of shameful. Bittersweet, in a single day, the Scottish Government gives with one hand but takes away with another. The Conservative amendment was drafted before that news emerged. As can be seen, we refer to significant concerns that a new national board for HIE may lead to a centralisation of services at the expense of the local skills, knowledge and expertise of HIE. Of course.
Hamza Youssef.
I'll look to take forward some of these arguments in my closing remarks, but when he describes it as centralisation, it's worth pointing out that the phase one of the review mentioned that a new vehicle should be set up for the south of Scotland. And what we said is HIE will remain. That service delivery is important on the ground, and that will remain as well. Does he not think that people on the ground will be more important, more more interested in the service delivery on the ground as opposed to where boards are sat or not?
Donald Cameron.
The point is that the board of HIE is what is important because it is that which gives voice to local people on the ground. And it's ironic for the Scottish Government to hold a debate entitled Supporting and Strengthening Our Island Communities on the very day that it announced its scrapping of the HIE board, an institution that has done more than any other in supporting and strengthening those communities over the years. And this heralds, in my view, the next step in the SNP's centralising agenda. On one level, I find this strange. I've seen the SNP island membership close up as a candidate in places like Skye, in Orkney and Shetland, in Bute and in Mull. And whatever differences we've had over the constitution, I've never been in any doubt that they were also local activists pushing local issues. And in this chamber, in the short time I've been here, I've been impressed by the vigour with which SNP MSPs representing the islands have campaigned on local matters, which is why I find the centralising instincts of the SNP government so puzzling. It's so out of kilter with that. But sadly, we know that's where, inexorably, this government is travelling. Yet again, the cold, grey hand of central government reaches out, this time to threaten an institution that has, without doubt, been a force for good in our islands, not least because it has a unique role in community development as well as business development, an expertise, and I'd like to make some progress, actually, an expertise which might get lost through centralisation. Island communities are an asset that we must value and strengthen for their current and future residents and for Scotland more broadly. The islands are essential to Scotland's identity and economy, as cherished as my own hands are to me. In my maiden speech, I quoted John Donne, "No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main." I still take this to mean that the lives of those who inhabit the periphery of Scotland are as important as the lives of those in the towns and cities of central Scotland. Nowhere is this truer than on our islands. They may be physically separate from the mainland, but that is all. We must create a fair and diverse economic environment for the whole of Scotland, where there is parity between north and south, east and west, island and mainland. Because that doesn't exist at the moment. In general, economic growth is not evenly spread across the country. And what better reason could there be for a dedicated regional board to promote enterprise within the Highlands and Islands? And in terms of our islands, we clearly need to do more to encourage businesses existing and new to develop, thus continuing to make our islands attractive places to work and live. And whilst many island businesses might be small with perhaps a few employees, these small enterprises still have a significant role in sustaining island communities. Crucial to this is developing new areas of activity that embrace an island's particular assets, its culture, its language, its heritage, its landscape, even its remoteness. Many successful businesses have embedded these assets as core elements of their offering. Of course.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the member for giving way and for mentioning the small businesses that, which flourish on islands. Will he sympathise with a number of those small businesses in islands who have contacted me and other island members to express concern that many of their workforce who are from other European countries lack much certainty about their future residency in this country?
Donald Cameron.
Well, I accept that there is uncertainty, and I have, as I have in debates on health, expressed my support for those people who are EU nationals living and working in Scotland. But the point I'm making is that these are businesses that have embedded these assets as core elements of their offering, giving them a competitive advantage over the mainland. The remote and rural nature of islands might present many challenges, but there are entrepreneurs with vision who have made a virtue of location and environment. The Isle of Harris Gin Company, Hebridean Sea Salt, Harris Tweed, and the Ethical Shellfish Company on Mull, to name but a few. Social enterprise, too, has a place in the island economy, and the connectedness of communities means that such businesses arise through identifying very specific needs of the people living there, bringing both economic benefit and social cohesion. Now, it's a truism that building the appropriate infrastructure to support economic growth is crucial to success, but it bears repeating. Every business needs appropriately skilled staff and to be connected digitally and physically to its markets. Reaching those customers requires robust and reliable communications, including broadband and transport networks. We can't ignore the challenges. There are some 93 inhabited Scottish islands with a population in excess of 103,000. And whilst there has been some growth, as the Minister pointed out, there has been a significant population decrease in recent years, and in our Gaal and Bute Islands in particular, that has been severe. We need to retain people, but we also need to attract people. People are, of course, the heart of a community. People who live and work and who believe that they and their children have a future in that place. And if that belief is not there, communities languish and eyes turn to the horizon. Parents want better for their children, and young people will leave the islands because they cannot see a sustainable future for them and their families. Now, a recent survey by the Scottish Islands Federation ranked the importance of challenges from the perspective of islanders, and it will come as no surprise that broadband was one of the biggest barriers to development. Others will mention housing. A business owner on Mull recently asked what single thing she wished for to transform her commercial diving business. The answer, affordable housing, housing that would allow her to attract appropriately skilled employees to live and work on Mull. Despite challenges, island communities rate highly year on year in happiness surveys, with the Western Isles top of the list. The recent advert for a teacher for Muck Primary School was inundated with applications from around the world, and Orkney, Shetland and the Western Isles have been named as the best places to bring up children. Now, whilst the Scottish Government has proposed additional powers and functions for island councils, we must turn words into action. For the first time, the Government is now bringing forward an islands bill, at last acknowledging through primary legislation the significant place of island communities in Scotland's national identity. Strategies to strengthen island communities will not come without a broad and inclusive discourse, and so it is worrying to find that almost a third of people surveyed said that they felt that islands have a limited voice in local and national issues. We must strive to give island communities their own voice and the confidence to speak up, and then we must listen to what is being said. Which takes me back, finally, to HIE, because HIE has been instrumental in providing that voice for the island. Having its own board allows it to advocate for the region as a whole. Without it, HIE will simply be swallowed up in the machinery of central government. There is widespread support for HIE across all parties, and members here will voice that during this debate more eloquently than me. But can I address my closing remarks to those SNP MSPs who represent the islands? As they will know, HIE has worked for decades across island communities, buttressing often fragile economies. As an agency has built up huge reserves of local knowledge and skills, it's not perfect, and we mustn't sentimentalise it. But it has quietly and slowly helped business flourish by applying a real understanding as to how resources can be best used locally and amongst the small communities within which it operates. Please don't stand by and watch it vanish.
I now call Rhoda Grant to speak to and move Amendment 2686.4. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by paying tribute to our island councils for promoting the vision of Our Islands, Our Future. They've worked across three council areas, recognising the differences in their communities, but choosing to work together to benefit the people they serve. Our Islands, Our Future is one of the defining factors, has one of the defining factors running through it, and that is subsidiarity. Decision-making should be as local as possible. We in the Scottish Labour Party agree with that principle. Let us empower communities and indeed local government to make decisions that reflect their own specific needs. Our islands work together in many ways, but none of them are saying that decisions made for one island group will work for another island group. They want to be allowed to make their own decisions that serve the distinct needs of their own local communities. Since I was elected to serve the Highlands and Islands, I heard the complaint over and over again that policies made with urban areas in mind are then foisted onto rural areas where they're not suitable and can sometimes be detrimental. The Island Council's campaign has forced the government to consult on legislation, and we will gauge the government's commitment to empower island communities by the shape of that legislation. Sadly, nothing that the minister said in his opening speech today has given an indication of where those powers will lie. The principle of devolving power is not something that this government practices, and we've only seen increasing centralisation. Our island councils used to... Very quickly.
John Mason.
Least accept that this government stopped ring fencing for local authorities and that local authorities have more power than they had before 2007?
Rhoda Grant.
Sadly, what has happened is that nothing is ring fenced because there is nothing there to ring fence. Their budgets have been cut year on year, and that is disempowering island communities as well. Island communities that used to have seats on the police board and indeed on the fire board, and those positions of influence have gone. We had the historic concordat that went with the non-ring fencing. It was sold as freeing up councils to make their own decisions locally, but in practice it left councils only able to deliver more cuts and more cuts. In fact, they're at a point now where they're only able to implement their statutory duties passed on to them by this government and this parliament. So the concordat has not worked. And now we hear rumours that even some of those statutory duties that are currently in place will be removed from councils, disempowering them even more. Therefore, I don't think it's cynical to question what new powers will be devolved to our islands. None have been so far. How can the government look both ways at once? Their rhetoric of empowering communities is good, but the practice is the absolute opposite. Therefore, those devolved powers have to be real, measurable and deliver change. Can I turn to Highlands and Islands Enterprise, which indeed is a case in point? And sadly, this government is going to downgrade high. They are going to be governed by a board which also will serve the whole of Scotland, so much for serving the Highlands and Islands. If the board has no understanding of the needs of our remote island communities, how on earth can they support them to grow their economies? The government has to come back from this wrong-headed decision, listen to the concerns expressed pretty much unanimously throughout the Highlands and Islands, and give us back our board. If they're serious about empowering communities, they have to show that now and now step back from that desperate decision. Transport is essential to our Highlands as well, and they depend on ferries and flights to connect to the rest of the country. Yet Islanders get very little say in service design and indeed their mainland links, and decisions are being made in Edinburgh by those with little or no understanding of their needs or wishes. Surely our island councils are in a prime position to advise and influence these decisions. When the new ferry was planned between Stornoway and Ullapool, the council and the local community asked for two smaller, faster ferries to give more sailings at peak times, and this was absolutely ignored by the government. Since then, we've seen incidences where a second boat would have been put to good use, especially during dry docking for maintenance of the fleet. Our island communities must be involved in these decisions and not just consulted and then simply ignored. Our amendment talks about the issues that lead to depopulation of the islands, and indeed these can affect our rural mainland areas too. We debated fuel poverty last week, so I won't rehearse the issues. Suffice to say that our islands suffer among the highest levels of fuel poverty, and we need to address that. Also, islanders pay a premium on goods and services due to distance and transportation costs, and indeed RET in not being extended or indeed being taken away from commercial vehicles. At this time, we're looking forward to Christmas. People living in urban areas pop to the shops for their Christmas shopping. If you're on an island, you also need to revert to mail order to get everything you need. Many companies that deliver to islands charge a premium. Others will not even deliver at all because of the added costs. Those who need to buy off island would also appreciate the ability to do this online, but again, they suffer poorer broadband connections and download speeds, preventing them from shopping around. Island living is wonderful, but it does have its challenges. These challenges lead to depopulation. St Kilda holds a strange fascination for people who come from remote communities, and I share that fascination. I wonder at the desperation of the people of St Kilda who left their homes en masse just because they could no longer survive due to dwindling numbers. And I wonder what went through their minds as they reached that awful conclusion. I sincerely hope that no other island communities will ever face that decision in the future, and it's our job to make sure that they do not. We have to support vibrant island communities, create jobs and services that are fit for purpose, and we need to provide transportation and connectivity links that allow them to communicate with the rest of the country and indeed way beyond. Who wouldn't want to live on an island? And Donald Cameron made that point with the happiness surveys. To enjoy the quality of life, but also to be able to build a future for yourself and your family. We know that local people are much better at finding solutions because they know the challenges. Those on the outside looking in can only have their own preconceptions, and they're seldom born out in reality. If the Scottish Government are serious about empowering island communities, they have to pull back on their decision of high, and they have to devolve powers rather than centralise them. Presiding Officer, actions speak louder than words, and I move the amendment in my name.
I now call Liam MacArthur to speak to and move Amendment 2686.1. Mr MacArthur, up to 7 minutes.
Thanks,
please.
Very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. 12 months ago, I participated in a similar debate about empowering our island communities. I'm always pleased to do so, but it strikes me that little has changed in the intervening period, save for the ministerial name on the motion. Now, I very much welcome Humza Yousaf's appointment and the approach he's taken to the role, but while he cannot personally be held responsible for many of the criticisms I will outline this afternoon, it is up to him to make the progress his predecessors failed to. Progress on reducing the cost of accessing our lifeline ferry and air service. Progress on radically improving broadband and mobile coverage and radically reducing levels of fuel poverty. And progress on genuinely abandoning a top-down, one-size-fits-all, centralising approach to legislation and policy making. As I said in the last debate, establishing this Parliament was supposed to be about seeing power devolved within and not just to Scotland, recognising, as all good Liberals do, that power rests with the people. It's passed up and pooled only by consent and where necessary. It's about giving people and communities the tools and the flexibility they need to shape their own futures, trusting them to take decisions that meet their own needs and circumstances. That concept seems to sit uncomfortably with SNP ministers. It jars with the narrative of one Scotland speaking with one voice, where the SNP talk of the interests of the people of Scotland as if these are homogenous and any contrary view is somehow by definition less or un-Scottish. It is this that has allowed for the relentless removal of powers and decision-making from our island communities over the last 9 years. Of course, the three island authorities, to their enormous credit, have sought to redress this through Our Islands, Our Future. And I'm pleased this has prompted the government to bring forward an islands bill and islands plan. Interestingly, when Tavish Scott and I made a similar case for giving more powers and responsibilities to the islands we represent, we were denounced by Nicola Sturgeon and others in her party as troublemakers. So, a welcome change in tone from the SNP, but what is the U-turn in rhetoric delivered in practice? Orkney and Shetland remain the only island communities excluded from the government's cheaper ferry fare scheme. All island businesses still face higher airfares thanks to the SNP government's cut to the air discount scheme. Police in all three island communities continue to grapple with a botched centralisation that undermines the ethos of community policing that is the hallmark of island forces. To be fair, these are now long-standing examples of this government's failure to walk the talk on strengthening our islands. So has anything changed more recently? Sadly, no. I'll give way to the Minister.
Hamza Youssef.
He's been most ungenerous, if I may say. I mean, the air discount scheme, of course, went from 40% to 50%. In terms of digital connectivity, I was amazed that he didn't mention the figures of connectivity, of course, when his own colleague was in government, when the Liberal Labour administration was in executive, and to what it is now, and by the fact that expected coverage in 2017 is expected in Orkney to be 75% and 80%. So could he be a little bit more generous that progress actually has been made in some very crucial areas?
Ian McArthur.
I'll turn to these in a minute, although he's I think, pointed out the fact that digital connectivity in Orkney falls 10% shorter, further back than it is in the rest of the Highlands and Islands, and 20% lower than it is nationwide. To be fair, these are now long-standing examples of the government's failure to walk the talk. So has anything changed? Well, while his officials have been busy finishing his islands bill, Mr. Youssef's ministerial colleagues have been busy driving a coach and horses through the concept of island proofing. The First Minister's attainment fund ignores the needs of children in poverty in Orkney and other island communities. Why are they less deserving of the additional support their counterparts in communities in the Central Belt receive? Meanwhile, health ministers are developing plans that could see island health boards submerged within larger mainland boards. This would inevitably see the specific needs and interests of patients and health staff in Orkney relegated in importance and will be fiercely resisted in the community I represent. And on economic development too, we saw confirmation yesterday, as Donald Cameron pointed out, by the Deputy First Minister, that any vestige of local autonomy and accountability within HIE is to be abolished. It is against this backdrop that the Minister, whom I do like and respect enormously, has his work cut out in demonstrating to a sceptical public in Orkney and other island communities that island proofing will be more than simply a tick box exercise. It will require a different way of doing things, a recognition that ministers don't know best, that one size does not fit all, and that island communities must be allowed both the power and the resources to make decisions that best reflect their needs. Yeah. By way of encouragement, let me offer a few examples of where early action might be taken to help build public confidence that this bill and plan can usher a different approach in from this government. The Minister knows about the chronically high proportion of households in the Northern and Western Isles that find themselves in fuel poverty. I would urge him to ensure, when the government updates its fuel poverty strategy next year, it allows maximum flexibility for communities to adopt approaches that work in the circumstances they face. This must include scope when building regulations to allow insulation measures to be maximised first, not just in housing, but in public buildings too. It's encouraging that heat pumps are now to be used in the new Balfour Hospital in Kirkwall, but covering the roof in solar panels that won't ever be connected, rather than increasing insulation of the building, makes no sense, and I'm sure Mr. Youssef would agree. He also needs to see support catch-up zones being established, targeting additional resources at those areas with the highest levels of fuel poverty. In the same way, I hope he will lend his support to catch-up zones for broadband and mobile phone coverage in island areas. Despite the welcome investment, a quarter of households and businesses in my constituency, not just the 16% across the Highlands and Islands as a whole, still have no access to fibre broadband. 2G, let alone 4G, remains a distant hope for many as well. These are now essential services, and before promising the next upgrade to those already with decent provision, I urge Mr Youssef to guarantee that those with poor or no service at all will have first call on any future funding. Finally, the Minister needs to take an urgent look at what is happening in relation to care services in Orkney. He will be aware, for example, that direct payments are supposed to be funded from savings released in other areas. Frankly, this just does not work in smaller island settings where alternative providers rarely exist. Orkney now has the highest level of self-directed support anywhere in the country, leading to service growth rather than simply reprovisioning. The coming into force shortly of the Carers Act may tip over the edge a service already struggling to cope. It's another example of where genuine island proofing is desperately needed, and I hope the Minister, along with his health colleagues, will agree to meet with me in Orkney Health and Care to discuss possible solutions. Presiding Officer, there are issues I've not covered, notably in relation to the powers over the seabed, but my colleague Tavish Scott will return to these in his wind-up remarks. Meantime, though, I hope the Minister, who I have enjoyed working with closely over recent months, now has a clearer sense of the scale of what is needed from him and his government. Urgent action to reduce costs on our lifeline transport links, a commitment to robustly test legislation and policy in terms of its effects on island communities, and a move away from a one Scotland mindset so that we trust people, particularly islanders, to take decisions that best reflect their interests and their circumstances, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. We move to the open debate. I would urge members, we're a bit tight for time, try and keep your remarks a bit shorter than you possibly originally intended, and then we'll have room for debate and discussion. Marie Todd, to be followed by Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've had a connection with the Scottish Islands my whole life. Not only did I spend all my holidays on my granny's croft in Lewis when I was growing up, but I was named after Lough Maree, which is well known for its islands as well as its beauty. Over 100,000 people live in our island communities, and the vast majority of those people live on the 87 inhabited islands in my region. So I'm delighted and proud to represent most of our islanders and most of our islands. I welcome that the government's motion recognises the contribution our islands make to Scotland's culture and to Scotland's economy. The islands punch above their weight in terms of influence in our culture. In fiction, islands are often places of magic and wonder, and it's been noted that writers such as Compton Mackenzie, Robert Louis Stevenson, J.M. Barrie and George Orwell all spent formative periods in the Hebrides. The islands punch above their weights in terms of the contribution to the Scottish economy too. We are well aware of the significance of their spectacular landscapes the islands have on Scottish tourism. I think we're also well aware of the island's contribution to our whisky industry. The world-famous brand names speak for themselves. Lafroig from Islay, Talisker from Skye, Highland Park from Orkney, as well as many others. But the island's contribution to Scotland's economy stretches much further than that. In Shetland alone, more fish is landed than in any other port in the UK. In fact, the Shetland Islands land more fish than England, Northern Ireland and Wales combined, a fifth of the UK total, worth 61 million last year, 2015. Our islands have an enormous energy potential. And although the frustration around grid constraints, which is of course controlled by the Westminster government, means it's hard to export this energy, this particular asset that we have on the islands, the level of innovation around energy storage is unparalleled, and I have no doubt that that knowledge will be exportable at some point in the future. On top of that, consider all of the distinctive products that come from our islands. We've got Orkney beef, Harris tweed, Stornoway black pudding, to name just a few. Island life can be challenging, and connectivity is the key. Travelling any sort of distance can be complicated, time-consuming, and expensive. Island life revolves around ferry and flight timetables. This government has already done a great deal for our island communities and has promised to do more. Thankfully, in Scotland, we have a government which delivers on its promises. This government protected discounts for air travel to the islands. And with RET, which has been a great success, now rolled out to all of the routes in the Clyde and Hebrides network, increasing visitor numbers and will stimulate the local economies. This government's frozen the cost of ferry fares for the Northern Isles, for Orkney and Shetland, and will look at a variant of RET in the coming months, one which works for the Northern Isles. This government's delivering on 100% broadband connectivity to all of Scotland, not just the islands, all of Scotland. Island-proofing legislation. And I would hope that island-proofing legislation will cover policy as well as legislation, but at least the ambition is there to look at island-proofing legislation. This government is ensuring that our island communities are empowered through the Island Strategic Group, and that will include all of the islands, not just the Western and the Northern Isles. This government is delivering on land reform. So the islands are leading the country. Approximately 70% of the people in the Outer Hebrides live on land, which is community owned. This government is going to ensure that the Crown Estate devolution will benefit the island communities as well as the coastal communities. So island life can be difficult. Islanders take this challenging life in their stride and have become determined and resilient people for it. As I often say, necessity is the mother of invention. So entrepreneurship flourishes in the islands. And on that note, I note the concerns expressed by the opposition amendments with regard to the changes proposed for Highlands and Islands Enterprise, an organisation which does fantastic work to ensure a sustainable economic future for my region. I would say that this scaremongering is not helpful. Nothing is going to change on the ground. I think HIE will benefit from Scottish enterprise expertise in attracting more international support.
Who was first?
Yes. If nothing will change on the ground, what is the need of a board at all if it doesn't make a difference to the people it serves?
Marie Todd.
I think the people on the ground will be exactly the same. The delivery on the ground will be exactly the same. What will improve is our connectedness between HIE and Scottish Enterprise, which will bring benefits in terms of international support, attracting inward investment, and enabling exports. I also think the advantage goes both ways. So I regularly highlight down here in Parliament about necessity being the mother of invention, and that sometimes because of the challenges that we face in Highlands and Islands, we're ahead of the pack in terms of creativity and innovation. The rest of Scotland would benefit from looking north a bit more often, and I hope that this change might encourage more of that. We can lead the way to sustainable economic growth for all of Scotland. And I have to say, with regard to the Conservative amendment, as many times before, I can hardly believe their lack of self-awareness. The biggest threat to skills, knowledge and expertise of HIE comes from their party's recklessness on Brexit, which is highly likely to damage the economy in the Highlands and Islands, which will cause a loss of people and a loss of funding. There will be no quick and easy solution to the challenges which face island communities, but I believe what we have seen is a determined government showing a firm commitment to taking on these challenges and developing our islands so that our island communities will be able to reap the benefits in future.
Douglas Ross, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I noted down the remarks the Minister made when he started today. He said, I am born and bred on a Glasgow estate, therefore I cannot say. And my heart stopped for a minute. I thought we're going to have another Hamza moment. I thought he was going on to say that he cannot say he's an expert in islands, just like he cannot say he's an expert in transport. But he didn't. He didn't. Well, it's nice to see you as well, Mr. Youssef. We've been competing for the newspaper columns this week, I see. But I was going to go on to say that if he wasn't an expert when he was given this position, he is certainly trying to increase his knowledge of the islands with the summer tour he did around our beautiful islands in Scotland. And as someone who has the great honour and privilege to represent the Highlands and Islands, I know the uniqueness each one has and what each individual island can offer to Scotland and the UK as a whole. And I think it's something we can celebrate, and I think it's something we are right to debate here in Parliament today. I agree with other members who have rightly praised the three island communities and the councils for their efforts over our islands, our future. They took the lead towards the end of the referendum campaign in 2014 to put a marker down, to say that regardless of the result of that referendum, more needed to be done to highlight the issues in the islands and ensure that we in this Parliament and we who make the laws ensure there is a creation made for the individual aspects of island work. And I think so far in this debate, bar a couple of points from Marie Todd, this has been a consensual debate, and I would expect that to continue. We all want to see the best in our islands. But I also think after 10 years, almost 10 years in government, the SNP members shouldn't be too prickly when there is some criticism of some aspects of this legislation that's coming through and aspects that go on in the islands. Many people, when devolution was delivered in 1999 and through successive governments, expected changes. And 10 years after an SNP government, we are still not seeing the island proofing, still not seeing the improvements in our islands that I think we can expect or many people expected to see. And I think it's right that we can make that we can make these observations and try and improve things as a Parliament as a whole. I'll give way to the Minister.
Minister.
On island proofing, he says it's amazing that in 10 years they haven't seen progress on it. Can he confirm whether or not island proofing was in his manifesto or indeed any Conservative manifesto for this Parliament?
Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What I was saying was the people in the islands look to their parliament to improve things for them. And I think they would be looking over the last 10 years and since devolution was delivered and said not enough has been done. That's why Our Islands, Our Future was launched. They didn't think enough was being done. They wanted to see more done in their local communities. It is something supported by all the parties in this chamber, and I think it's something we can move forward with. But I also wanted to pick up on a point. You know, we were speaking about digital connectivity, the road infrastructure, more devolution from the centre to local communities. And while these issues are acute in the islands, they are the same issues we have across the Highlands and across Scotland. So while it's issues that we as Highlands and Islands members raise, they're also raised by every one of the 129 elected to this chamber. So yes, there are bigger problems in the islands, but they share many of the same problems as people across Scotland. Liam MacArthur made the point, however, that certainly with digital connectivity, Orkney Islands are 20% behind the rest of Scotland. So while they share the same problems, it's almost always far more acute in these communities. I want to briefly mention the great work done by HIE. I've seen that for myself in Moray and across the Highlands and Islands, and I think it was right that Conservatives put forward our amendment today. It was almost looking into the future, as we saw the announcement yesterday, that is troubling people. And I noted what Marie Todd said. She noted the concerns and then went on to dismiss them completely. And I think that is unwise, because there are genuine concerns in our communities, which we both represent, with these changes to HIE. And I certainly haven't heard anything from any SNP member or the Minister, perhaps we will in summing up, to reduce those concerns in the community. And I think that's something we will be looking for very closely. And the point I would make on that, the Scottish Government announced in March 2016 the feedback to the Empowering Our Islands consultation. There were almost 200 responses, and one of the areas that they highlighted in their own press release about that consultation, it says a one-size-fits-all approach to legislation, policy and services doesn't take into account the requirements of life on Scotland's islands into consideration. And I worry if we move away to a centralised HIE that accountability for the island communities will be diminished significantly, and that's why there are concerns on these benches and I believe many benches across Parliament. There's many issues I'd like to pick up on, particularly about policing. There are concerns across Scotland, and these are also shared across the island communities, about the centralisation of the police forces, the accountability to local communities, when councillors from Orkney and Shetland and the Western Isles used to sit on the Northern Joint Police Board and had an influence, that is taken away. I'd also like to have spoken a bit longer, but I understand the time constraints, Presiding Officer, about the many tourism aspects in our islands and how they can be helped, not hindered, a lot of the time. But if I can end on a positive note, Yes, there's challenges for people living on our islands, but there are also many benefits and opportunities. And sometimes I think we've got to be careful in this chamber that we don't only look at the things that are wrong or are difficult on living on our islands. We've got to look at the positives to encourage people to move there, to encourage people to stay there. And therefore, then I think any island proofing that we can move forward with as a parliament and with the Scottish Government, I think will be a benefit to everyone currently there and people considering moving there in the future. Thank you.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And with the huge diversity of islands that we have in Scotland, the focus is often on geographically more distant communities such as Orkney, Shetland and the Outer Hebrides. And while these are undoubtedly impacted due to the distance from mainland facilities, every island is unique with its own set of challenges. As a member for Cunningham North, I represent the Isles of Arran, Cumbria and Holy Isle, with just over 4,600, 1,400 and 31 inhabitants respectively. They each have a very distinctive character. Holy Isle is owned by the Sam Ye Ling Buddhist community, whose settlements in the island include the Centre for World Peace and Health. On the southern end of the island lives a community of nuns undertaking three-year retreats. The remainder of the island is treated as a nature reserve with wild Eriskay ponies, Sanin goats, Soey sheep and the rock whitebeam tree unique to Holy Isle and Arran. Cumbrae and uninhabited Wee Cumbrae together boast a castle, lighthouse, cathedral of the Isles, Field Studies Council, Cumbria National Sports Scotland Sailing Centre and the famous Crocodile Rock. Known to Glaswegians by Town Millport, Cumbrae is Scotland's cycling island. And like all island communities, it has challenges. Yet the community is ambitious, seeking to develop a community care hub on the island and together with Largs attract the World Parasailing Championships. The SNP manifesto contained a clear and substantial promise to empower island communities, and the newly elected SNP government has indeed wasted no time living up to this commitment. Only 3 months into government, a consultation on the Islands Bill has already been carried out, and a dedicated island strategic group formed, which includes North Ayrshire Council covering the Cumbrae and Arran. I welcome the approach being taken, and the SNP government is under no illusions regarding the importance and scale of improvements required to better serve our island communities. It's vital to ensure that issues affecting island communities continue to be actioned under existing frameworks and ministerial portfolios as we progress. And indeed, Tavi Scott touched on health as one of those earlier. There is an obvious example in my own constituency of how important it is that the right decisions are made at a ministerial level. One objective set forth in the Islands Manifesto is investment in quality ferry services. And I quote, to keep ferry fares as low as possible and provide concessionary travel to our older people. There is a reason they are called lifeline ferry services. Now, over the past few years, the SNP government has driven massive improvements to our ferry services to both Arran and Cumbrae. The introduction of road equivalent tariff led to a huge reduction in ferry fares and a current freeze resulting in a significant increase in passenger and vehicle numbers. The number of summer sailings will increase the new 12.3 million hybrid ferry MV Katrina serving the Lochranza to Cloning route entered service in September, increasing comfort and capacity while reducing emissions. And I was delighted that the Minister was there for the launch of that. A new £47 million ferry now being built in Port Glasgow to serve the Ardrossan to Brodick route will allow for two vessels to sail the route all year round and will be another massive boost. Meanwhile, a new £28 million harbour is being built in Brodick to be completed in the spring, which will greatly increase capacity from the car park to the terminal to the number of vessels that can dock. As a consequence of investment by this government, Arran's economy grew by a thumping 10% last year, more than China's. The 182-year-old ferry route between Brodick and Ardrossan has seen and should continue to see further improvements, benefiting both the local economy of Arran and Ardrossan on the mainland, and Ardrossan our task force was set up with a view to making investment to serve Arran. However, Associated British Ports has put in a hostile bid to move the service from Ardrossan to Troon, which at 18 nautical miles would make the journey 50% longer, increasing sailing times, ferry prices and decreasing the number of sailings, impacting on capacity, affordability and competitiveness. It would also damage the North Ayrshire economy by some £4.7 million a year and make it harder for North Ayrshire Council to service Arran, costing 165 jobs in Ardrossan. Troon Harbour doesn't even have a railway station, whereas Ardrossan Harbour, the train comes right up to the terminal. Thus, moving the ferry to Troon would also be against the government's manifesto commitment of making public transport accessible to older people who represent a significant percentage of Arran's residents and visitors. For those reasons, among others, I'm confident the impending stag will only serve to highlight that Drossan is the best berthing place in Ayrshire for this lifeline Arran ferry service. Of course, Arran's not all about ferries. It's a beautiful island, Scotland in miniature, it is often called, with feisty people who support the July 2013 undertaking with the SNP government that islands should enjoy the maximum degree of local decision-making. Island folk want to make things happen. Whether it is Arran Aromatics, or Hraney Resort, or Taste of Arran, we have strong businesses. And indeed, according to Cottages and Castles, things are going well. An accommodation provider, it says that bookings have rocketed 47% this year. A new distillery we built in South Arran, representing a £10 million investment, while the distillery in picturesque Lochranza invested in new facilities in what was a record year for visitors. Superfast broadband, while not yet delivered to the standard we expect, is making significant progress. Mobile coverage is another issue, and the UK government actually wrote to me some 2 years ago on this, saying that Arran was not a priority. So I would ask some of our Tory colleagues to perhaps, who aspire to represent Arran and other islands, to perhaps speak to their colleagues at UK in order to get that thing moving. On 28th October, Glenkiln Hydro opened, which will generate enough electricity to power up to 500 homes and provide 15% of Arran's electricity. Presiding officer, I've tried to bring across how important it is to island communities that their voices, irrespective of size or remoteness, are heard, whether through island proofing or the existing framework. In delivering this to Islands Bill, it's clearly a step in the right direction when it comes to giving island communities more input to decision making, and it's about time that more tailor-made policies were put in place for our islands.
Thank you. I call on Neil Bibby to follow by Emma Harper. I would urge all members who haven't spoken yet to think ahead, try and lose a paragraph each from your speeches. Thank you. Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think we'd all agree that Scotland's islands are a vital part of the mosaic which gives Scotland its character. Our islands are renowned all over the world for their beauty, rich culture and heritage. When tourists talk of Scotland, they admire the Highlands and our cities such as Edinburgh and Glasgow. But for those who have visited the islands, it is the taste and experience of the islands that leaves them with the longest lasting impression. My own appreciation of the significance of our islands has deepened since I married into a family from the Isle of Lewis. From my not frequent enough visits there, I have learned that while there is pride in the beauty of the islands, their community and culture, there's also sometimes a deep sense of frustration that the platitudes and inaction emanating from this place can often make it harder to sustain that unique way of life. If we're to truly value the contribution of our islands, we need to make rich, then we have to recognise that action is needed to avoid these island communities turning into a living museum, quaint and fascinating for tourists, but struggling to provide a future for the local young people who are truly the lifeblood of our islands. All of our islands have a distinct contribution to make, but in the case of the Western Isles, there is the added imperative in being the bastion of Gaelic as a living language. And a working language. These islands need to thrive for the language to thrive. I also want to draw the Chamber's attention to an excellent blog written by Torco Crichton, who members will know is the Westminster editor of the Daily Record. As a native of Lewis, a one-time resident of Skye, and someone who's steeped in the culture and heritage of the islands, Torco tells us about a friend of his who, as a young man on Skye in 1996, could afford to build his own home. He did it with a rural housing grant and a mortgage 2.5 times his salary. Those opportunities just would not be available to islanders these days. Now, today's motion is well-meaning. It would be a worthy statement of intent from a newly elected government which needs time to develop its ideas and its programme. But it has to be said, the reality is that it's an account of a government which has been in office for nearly 10 years. Perhaps it would be better to judge the government's motion on, not by what it says, but what it doesn't. There needs to be far more, as I've mentioned already, there needs to be far more specifics on the housing crisis, one of the forces driving depopulation. There needs to be more proposals for job and wealth creation to give young islanders a future. There needs to be more recognition of fuel poverty, inequality or the cost of living on the islands. And there needs to be more mention of the erosion of local services or that sense of disempowerment that comes from remoteness, not just a geographical remoteness, but a sense of being removed from the decision-making in this parliament too. Today I want to highlight one of the dominant political issues on the island of Arran right now in my own region, and I want to make sure that the concerns of people in Arran are heard. Arran is different in many respects from Scotland's other islands, but it too suffers from remoteness and reliance like other islands, on a lifeline ferry service. And as Kenny Gibson has said, there is a proposal to change the ferry service from Brodick, which for 177 years has travelled to Ardrossan, and change that to Troon. At a stroke, this would increase, as Kenny Gibson has rightly said, the length of journeys from 21 kilometres to 29 kilometres, with a return journey taking 50 minutes longer. It could reduce the frequency of sailings. Foot passengers would face a 15% increase on return fares, and islanders working on the mainland would have to pay an extra £299 per year for a five-day commute. Car and driver fares would also increase to £47.29 return, an increase of more than 20%, which equates to £2,493 annual increase for a five-day commute. There's no evidence that Troon would be a more reliable option for ferry sailings. The vast majority of ferry cancellations at Ardrossan are made due to fog and high winds, but that would be the same fog and high winds that affect other Clyde ports, including Troon. Any change of destination would create problems for the residents of Arran and for North Ayrshire Council, as Kenny Gibson also raised, which is the local authority that covers Arran and provides lifeline services for the island. Troon is in South Ayrshire, across the local authority boundary. Ardrossan has immediate access to rail services, unlike Troon, and has better road links to Glasgow and Edinburgh and their airports. All of those links are vital for the tourism industry, which is such a major part of Arran's economy. Islanders working on the mainland may need to reassess their job situation with increased travel costs, as may those living on the mainland but working on Arran. Private and public investment in the regeneration of Ardrossan would also be undermined at a stroke. The regeneration around the marina in Ardrossan would be thrown into doubt. In short, Arran is an island facing an unexpected and unnecessary economic and social challenge. While it may be different challenge to some of the broader ones or other islands face, it is a challenge more than easily resolved. Presiding officer, today we should give a commitment, as in the Labour amendment, across the chamber to hear the concerns of islanders and keep that ferry going from A to B, from Ardrossan to Brodick. And I would urge the Minister and the Scottish Government to show their commitment by listening to the islanders in Arran and the people of Ardrossan on this important issue as well. Thank you.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Andy Whiteman. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have this opportunity to speak in this afternoon's debate, even though the south of Scotland is not known for its islands. Having said that, the remoter parts of the rural southwest have occasionally doubled for Scottish islands, most famously perhaps parts of Galloway, including Creetown and the Isle of Whithorn, featured as fictional summer isle in the original film of The Wicker Man. And more recently, the villages of Port Logan and Port Patrick appeared as the fictional island of Ronanse in the BBC series 2000 Acres of Sky. Indeed, there are many similarities between the challenges facing the most remote parts of the southwest and many of the Scotland's islands communities, to the extent that I sometimes feel that the only thing we are missing is being separated from the mainland by water. When I returned to Scotland with my husband, we seriously considered setting up in Islay. We were attracted by its beauty as well as the sense of community, although ultimately we decided to return to my home of Dumfries and Galloway. That consideration was enough to convince us that opting for island life would not be an easy choice. And it's with that realisation in mind, however remote we in the south might feel, I do recognise that the unique characteristics and variety of Scotland's island communities are important, and they need to be recognised and constitute a diverse archipelago where there are different priorities and needs. So I welcome and support the government's undertaking to create a national islands plan, as well as establishing the island strategic group, which will be chaired by the islands minister, on which every island local authority is represented. The specific challenges facing island communities have been addressed by others already in this debate. I want to pick up on a couple of specific issues because they are as familiar to me in Galloway as they will be to residents of Islay or Stronsay. One area of interest is the devolution of Crown Estate and the incomes to the island and coastal councils. For these councils, their marine assets are crucial, so it may make sense for them to have control over the revenue raised through the Crown Estate and be accountable for how it is invested back into their communities. I also want to touch on fuel poverty. as again the combination of hard to heat, hard to treat houses and higher costs of supply associated with off-grid fuels such as LPG present a situation for many of our island communities, which is a familiar one for the most remotest parts of my region too. The government's commitment to a holistic approach to tackling the problem of island fuel poverty is very welcome, and I was particularly pleased to see the inclusion of microgeneration schemes for off-gas grid homes in the National Warmer Homes Scheme, since that will apply to both island and remote mainland homes. I also welcome the work outlined in the government's March 2016 progress update on a bespoke approach to promoting our islands as tourist destinations. It makes sense to invest extra effort in marketing destinations which are certainly have a strong brand but equally take a bit more of an effort to reach. I am certain that it is for the South, tourism continues to grow and be a great sector for our islands. Finally, Presiding Officer, my interest in this issue, I have to confess, is as much because I hope there may be scope to take some of the good practice which is developing in terms of national policy, the devolution of powers, not centralisation, and specific focus on the challenges which are unique to island life, and apply some of that to the very similar issues which affect most rural parts of the south of Scotland. For some considerable time, for example, we have looked in envy at the work of Highlands and Islands Enterprise and hope for a similar agency to do similar things for our region. We started to make progress with the NUTS 2 designation reclassification and the prospect of unlocking greater European structural funding only this spring, then to be confronted with Brexit. And the issues mentioned this afternoon of depopulation, demographics, fuel poverty and connectivity are very much issues we have in common with our island communities. Presiding Officer, this is a debate about Scotland's island communities and the government's strategy to embed island-friendly policy in the heart of national decision-making. As I have said, I very much support that approach, but as a member interested in issues of peripherality and rural connectivity, who does not represent any inhabited islands, I will be watching progress with these matters in the hope that there are lessons to be learned and good practice which can be applied to other parts of Scotland too. After all, if Galloway can pass for an island on the big and small screens, maybe we can also benefit from some of the good things that we have heard in this afternoon's debate too. Thank you.
Thank you. Andy Whiteman to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate this afternoon, not least because it gives me the opportunity to challenge members to answer my favourite pub quiz question, which is to identify where in Scotland one can find an island in a loch on an island in a loch on an island. I see Humza Yousaf is preparing to do some research there. I would like to congratulate the island's authorities for their smart and effective campaign, Our Islands, Our Future, in the run-up to the independence referendum. The campaign also reflects a more historical analysis of the distribution of political power across the British Isles. The historian James Hunter tells a story which sums up much of the relationship between the Highlands and the rest of Scotland. In the run-up to the 1979 devolution referendum, Hunter recalls, an old man in Sutherland, a man who couldn't have been more pro-Highland, told me he'd be voting to keep the status quo. Why, I asked. Well, he said, in London they don't give a damn about Highlanders, but in Edinburgh they hate us. Much of that ill feeling has deep historical roots in the tendency of authorities in Edinburgh to dictate the fate of those living elsewhere in Scotland. And that's why the Our Islands, Our Future campaign is so important. It recalls the success of Shetland in the 1970s in securing the Zetland County Council Act of 1974. It recalls the findings of the Montgomery Committee over 30 years ago that argued for precisely what the island authorities are arguing for now. The campaign led to the fabled Lerwick Declaration. This sounded very grand, so I decided to have a wee look and find out what this declaration was. To my disappointment, I discovered that the Lerwick Declaration is no more than the spoken thoughts of the then First Minister, Alex Salmond, who in a speech in Lerwick on the 29th of July 2013 said, "There is a hugely important principle behind all this and one which matters in all parts of Scotland, so let's call it the Lerwick Declaration." We believe, he went on, that the people who live and work in Scotland are best placed to make decisions on Scotland's future. That's the very essence of self-determination for the nation, and therefore it follows as night follows day that we support subsidiarity and local decision-making. Now, such a statement falls short, I think, of normal definitions of a declaration, but nevertheless, what was in effect the Scottish Government's response to the campaign at that stage was widely welcomed by island authorities. But just as the people who live and work in Scotland are best placed to make decisions on Scotland's future, so too then are the people who live and work on Skye and Mull and Arran also best placed to make decisions on the future of Skye, Mull and Arran. And across Europe, such communities typically do enjoy substantially greater autonomy to a far, far greater degree than is the case in Scotland. Furthermore, the ambitions that are being developed for islands, communities and authorities are exactly the same kind of ambitions that we should be developing for all communities and authorities across Scotland. Notwithstanding the important and distinctive needs of islands and island authorities, some of which are highlighted in opposition amendments, which we will be supporting this evening, it's clear that more powers, greater fiscal autonomy and strengthened local democracy are ambitions we should be seeking to achieve for all communities across Scotland. Presiding Officer, my amendment to the debate, although not selected, highlighted the importance of decentralising the governance of Crown property rights and interests once these are fully devolved to the Scottish Parliament. I want to remind Parliament that the Smith Commission recommended that the two substantive reservations in Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act 1998 over the management and of the revenues of what is currently referred to as the Crown Estate be done away with, and that the Scottish Parliament have full devolved competence over both management and revenues. The Scotland Act 2016 devolves the former, but not the latter, a major flaw in any claim that the 2016 Act has delivered the Smith Commission proposals in full. Notwithstanding that failure, the Act amends the Civil List Act 1952 to the effect that the revenue shall be paid into the Scottish Consolidated Fund. This is progress, but it will lead to potential difficulties where, for example, a harbour authority in Shetland relies on revenues derived from new developments on Crown land, but cannot directly secure the revenues deriving from this, instead having to presumably enter into a complex arrangement with Scottish ministers to secure that revenue. Which leads me to my closing point, Presiding Officer. Commitments have been given by previous governments, other parties, and most recently by the First Minister herself in Kirkwall on the 1st of June 2015 that, and I quote precisely, coastal and islands councils will benefit from 100% of the net revenue generated in their area from activities within 12 miles of the shore. These are not the same words used in the opening speech by Mr. Yusuf, and so I'd be grateful if the Minister, in concluding, could confirm that the First Minister's statements of June 2015 remains the position of the Scottish Government today. And finally, can I also ask the Minister if the Scottish Government is continuing to make the case to the UK Government for the repeal of Section 33A of Schedule 5, Part 1 of the Scotland Act 1998. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I rise, of course, as a member of a political party represented here, the only political party that actually owns its own island, Éireann Mór Vicar Cormac, which is off the coast of Argyll. We got gifted this, I think, 30 or 40 years ago. And over many years, members of the party have gone and started to rebuild the one building that's on there. But it doesn't count for very much. It's not a populated island. It's not economically valuable. But I'm going to propose that actually, economically, our islands are the most valuable part of Scotland. Now, that might seem a sort of slightly challenging and interesting thing to say. We think of the islands, of course, as soaking up our resources and being subsidised by us. If you think about it in a different way, the contrary view is true. And the most valuable island of all, uninhabited as it is Rockall. And why is Rockall so valuable? Because its existence as part of our territory is responsible for our having about a quarter of our offshore economic area. And with other islands, it gives us, I'll come in a minute, it gives us opportunity to harvest the seas, the fish that are there, and of course the oil. Mr. Whiteman.
Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. Does Mr. Stevenson claim that Scotland should have sovereignty over Rockall? It's a disputed territory, and it was also the last most recent act of colonialism by the British government.
Stuart Stevenson.
I think when Rockall came into the UK, I will be corrected if necessary in 1956, I think it was, if I recall. I think de facto it is accepted, it creates. But I make a general point that every part of Scotland makes is a unique contribution. And we shouldn't forget that the islands have their own unique contributions they make. Now, the Minister referred to a visit to Rasay, a sun-kissed island. I must say, my visit there, which was thoroughly enjoyable, my greatest memory is the midges. The population of Rasay, of course, remember, with some horror, Dr. Green, who owned the island and kept the whole economy and the whole island in thrall. And that, of course, was repeated elsewhere. On Gia, when Malcolm Potter owned Gia, the island could not make progress. So islands have been one of the areas where management buyouts, community buyouts, have transformed prospects. South Uist would be an example. The island of Gia would be another. For my part, I've just done quick arithmetic. I appear to have been to 20 populated islands. That's far from the whole panoply of our islands. And my father was born and brought up on Éile na Muachta, which, of course, really isn't an island, because in English we know that as the Black Isle. So not all things that are called islands and islands, Harris and Lewis being examples of that. But many of the characteristics of bits of the mainland are also the characteristics of islands. Now, I want to talk a wee bit about transport, because I've got some particular hobby horses I want to just get off my chest, and in particular in relation to aviation. Many of our islands are served by small aircraft that use motor fuel. They use petrol, avgas, as it's called in the trade. It is vatable. So the island services in the Orkneys, the Shetlands, out of Oban to the islands, they have to pay VAT on their fuel. And that's inherently unfair, because the big aircraft don't pay VAT on the aircraft fuel. And that's an issue we should look at. Similarly, we have restrictions on the aircraft types we can use to serve our islands. And that makes it more difficult to expand air services. Unlike Norway, where single-engined aircraft can operate full services in instrument conditions and service very small communities, that is not permitted in the UK, even though the American aviation authorities show that the safety records of single-engine aircraft under a maximum takeoff weight of 4,700 kilograms is better than the safety record of multi-engined aircraft in that category as well. I think, unless the presiding officer... Right, OK.
David Stewart.
The member for allowing me to intervene. I understood that CAA were actually changing the regulations for single piloted planes, which would have a benefit to the Highlands and Islands.
Stuart Stevenson.
Well, there's an already exemption for single piloted planes that applies in both Orkney and Shetland that the CAA. And indeed, that's helpful, but single engine plane would transform the prospects of some places not in the network. Conscious, presiding officer, of your strictures, let me just take a wee bit of issue with Donald Cameron. The issue of Highlands and Islands Enterprise and Scottish Enterprise, he sees gloom, I see opportunity. I'm the only constituency member where both Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise operate in my constituency. And believe me, the people in the SEs, oh, I beg your pardon, I'm corrected, Mr. Gibson as well. And the people in the Scottish Enterprise bit want to be in the HIE bit. If we can transfer some of the culture and practice of HIE to Scottish Enterprise, we'll end up in a much better place than we've been in the past. I don't think it's gloom and doom. And of course, I will campaign for the board meetings and headquarters to be in Inverness, not Glasgow or Edinburgh.
Thank you. I call Edward Mountain to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It appears that there is broad consensus across this chamber that we all agree that island communities are unique but very fragile in comparison to the rest of Scotland. What they show us is the importance of resilience and a real sense of community spirit, and I believe a strength in unity within the community, something that we should try and concentrate on and export from the islands across all of Scotland. Now, we all seem to agree that there should be further powers for the islands. And information, though, from the proposed bill from the Minister is rather notably and disappointingly vague. It doesn't indicate what powers should be devolved to the island, and I look forward to knowing what these proposals are. And when we do know them, if we believe they benefit the islands, I can assure you that we'll be supporting you in your drive to achieve that. Now, I believe more autonomy for island communities will allow them to champion the issues that face them, giving them better access to markets, transport and health. And I believe that this will attract talent to the islands, which will replenish, in some cases, declining population. I want to look at four areas, if I may. Before I look at the first one, I'm going to declare an interest that I am part of a farming partnership, but I want to talk about farmers. In particular, on islands, they face huge challenges. This is largely due not only to the geographical location, but also the landscape. One of the main sources of income is rearing stock, which is brought to the mainland by other farmers to finish them, because it's not always possible to finish them on the islands due to the short grazing seasons and harsh, wet winters. There's nothing we can do about the weather, but we can try and level the playing field for these farmers who live and work on the islands, who not only can be a disadvantage from having to move stock from one island to another when they're selling them, but also when they're grazing them. Helping them with the transport and ensuring movement restrictions do the job they're supposed to do, and not create another layer of complexity, would be a real benefit. So I believe if the government want to empower the island communities, options should be explored to assist farmers in making their businesses a success. We should look at specific issues that could be addressed, and this could be done under a new and progressive agricultural policy which will be required post 2020. Now, it's not just farmers who face challenges living in island communities. It's islands are falling behind when it comes, as we've heard, to facing and implementing broadband, super fast broadband. In the Western Isles, only 40% of the premises have access to fibre broadband. But not having sufficient access to broadband means that we don't attract businesses and people to the island. We have to have broadband in the island to get the communities there and to stay there. It's resources not only needed by businesses, but also for the children as they go through their education. So broadband is not just another problem for the islands, but it's one of a few. And I want to talk about the other one that I believe is important, which is the development costs. Now, for example, on Iona and Col, costs for house building are probably 30% higher than in urban areas across the whole of Scotland. This deters new entrants to the island and people moving in, and it deters people from developing. We need to look at this, and we need to look at ways of reducing these costs so we can encourage new housing on the islands. We also need to look at health, and health is a real issue. Due to the remote location of residents, a doctor's visit or a commute to a local service or hospital can be a daunting and difficult experience. Changes to services can cause great upheaval on the islands. And at present, as the Minister will know, the plans to redesign the services on Skye and Rasay, which I believe you visited in the summer. As we move to one hospital, it will mean that there'll be a huge amount of more movement on Skye. And in the situation on Rasay where there is no GP and there isn't going to be a GP, when the ferries stop in the evening, there is a real concern about what local people will have to do to get medical care. And let's be all honest with ourselves that if we can't get to see a GP in the evening when we've got a problem, we'd be concerned as well. And we need to address that. So I think we need to work with island communities and give them special cognizance when it comes to providing health care. And that can be done, as has been suggested in this bill, by giving them more autonomy. Now, there's one other issue I want to mention, and I'm mindful because the presiding officer will look at me as far as time is concerned. And I also want to mention the Highlands and Islands proposals for change. And I don't believe that's right. And I believe that Stuart Stevenson is right to say that it should remain in the Highlands, but it should remain in the Highlands with its own board. It's served the Highlands well. It's been a great service to the islands as well. And I believe it's a mistake to centralise it and take control away. And I'm afraid, Minister, when it comes to discussing this at further levels, we will be opposing that because we don't believe it's in the interests of the Highlands and Islands. So I believe there's a lot of things that we can work on together, and I believe there are positive areas which need to be addressed. And I would stress to the Minister, we need to look specifically at broadband, which I know the government is, specifically opportunities for farmers, specifically at healthcare, and specifically the idea of trying to make it more affordable for people to build houses on the islands if we're to retain populations there. Thank you.
Thank you. John Mason to be followed by David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sadly, I have no islands in my constituency. In fact, I don't think I even have an island in the River Clyde, of which I do have a part. But for a Glaswegian like me, going to an island is great, be that Millport on Cumbrae, Rothsay on Bute or Arran. For me at least, and I think for many other city dwellers, the pressures of life reduce as you cross the sea to an island. And of course, we know there are great pressures for people living on the islands. But for the rest of us, there is something great about being detached, and I think that is a huge attraction for tourists. So why do I want to speak in this debate as a city MSP? I'm sure other members here, of all parties, know their islands much better than I do. Stuart Stevenson says he's been to 20 inhabited islands. I think I have been to approximately 35. But I think it's worth stating that many people in Scotland's cities and the mainland generally do have a strong commitment to our islands. Maybe we have family ties, or we go on holiday to the same island every year, or just visit islands occasionally. But still, many of us believe that islands are a key part of our national culture, and I cannot imagine a Scotland without islands. We were asked to skip a paragraph, so I will skip the one about the definition of islands, as I was going to argue that Skye cannot be an island, maybe because it now has a bridge to the mainland. There is also a huge contrast between our islands. Cumbrae and Lismore are relatively close to Largs and Oban, with fairly short and, I think, dependable ferry crossings, whereas the Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland, are obviously much further from the mainland, have larger communities within them, and are clearly more self-sufficient. Having been a few times to the Western Isles before I ever got to Shetland, I was struck by the big difference between the two groups, and especially how cosmopolitan Lerwick is. Even neighbouring islands can be very different from each other. A few years ago, I split my summer holiday between Col and Tiree. Col is hilly with a very few people and a small shop that was only open half the day. Moving from there to Tiree was like arriving in a big city by comparison. I could not believe how well stocked the Co-op was there in comparison to what I had just experienced on Col. And the other year I was in the small isles, and the ownership models there are very interesting. The four small isles have four different models: Muck, traditional landowner; Egg, community trust buyout; Rum, I think SNH; and Canna, National Trust. Now, clearly we cannot discuss islands without focusing on transport, and I was as delighted as anyone when CalMac won the bid for the Clyde and Hebrides routes. I am a supporter of the European Union, but it has not been perfect, and perhaps one of the advantages of leaving could be that we are less tied in to competitive tendering. Road equivalent tariff has long made sense to me, and I think we should consider it one of the big successes of this government that it has been rolled out so far. Very quickly.
David Stewart.
First question to the member. The European Union's TECL exemption allows public sector organisations not to tender, and there is UK cases to establish that. So I'd ask the member to look at that particular point.
John Mason.
Quite long debates on that particular subject, but I just think there's a few areas where that it could give us a bit more room for manoeuvre. Now, I think we certainly should learn from neighbouring countries with islands. This last summer, I was in Ireland, and they seem to have a much more kind of free market system for island ferries, and you can get in one ferry, and there's another one competing by racing themselves across the sea to the island. Perhaps more interesting was when I visited the Faroe Islands and saw their use of tunnels. We have tended to build causeways and sometimes bridges to link islands together or islands to the mainland. But in visiting the Faroe Islands, clearly they use tunnels to a greater degree. I know this has been suggested for Orkney, and I would just suggest that we should consider tunnels as a serious possibility if we are looking at replacing ferries with fixed links in the future. During the last Parliament, I was on the Equal Opportunities Committee for part of the time, and we carried out a study on age and isolation, which included visiting both Islay and Easterhouse, to see how isolation in urban setting compared to a more rural or island setting. And I think most of us in the committee were struck, most of us were not from an island background, by the very strong sense of community in the island setting, perhaps more so than in an urban setting like Easterhouse. But clearly the island folk faced greater challenges in areas like transport and even professional isolation, so that if there is only one doctor, one teacher on an island community, they can be very isolated. Another paragraph, which I'll just skip over, I think was on the question of centralisation. I really do think this government has been good at getting rid of the ring fencing, which when I was a councillor was a real, real problem. And that has freed up both the island councils and, in fact, all the councils. Finally, both the government motion and the Labour amendment mention declining populations or depopulation. As a city dweller, that is something we all need to take seriously. I like living in the city, but it would not be good for the country if everybody lived in the cities. We need strong rural and island communities. One of the saddest stories of depopulation and evacuation has been the story of St Kilda, which Rhoda Grant referred to and which I loved when I visited it. Now it is a World Heritage Site with no permanent population and dominated by a military base, which I think is very unsuitable. Yet it has been a tourist attraction for over 100 years with potential for more. And so I would just finish with a challenge that not only must we not allow any more of our islands to become completely depopulated, and it should be a national priority to stop that happening, but maybe we should even consider repopulating some of our islands, like St Kilda. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call David Stewart, followed by Angus MacDonald. Mr Stewart, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The board's overall purpose must be to enable the Highlands and Islands to play a more effective part in the economic and social development of the nation. It's never been more important than today that all the country's resources should be fully exploited, and the Highlands and Islands have much to contribute. This is not a case of giving to the Highlands and Islands, this is a case of giving the Highlands and Islands a chance to play their full part in the future of Britain. Not my words, but from iconic Secretary of State for Scotland, Willie Ross, speaking in the Commons during the second reading of the bill, which set up the groundbreaking Highlands and Islands Development Board in 1965. Willie Ross was cast from the same mould as the great Tom Johnston, who as Secretary of State under Winston Churchill brought hydropower to the glens in the Highlands in the 1940s. Of course, much has changed in island communities today since Willie Ross's stirring speech echoed across Westminster. The discovery of oil and gas, the development of the University of Highlands and Islands with 5 of their 13 academic partners wholly based on the islands, CAP, the minimum wage, and the air discount scheme brought in by Tavish Scott when he was the Minister of Transport. Route development funding, road equivalent tariff, rural fuel rebate, and European structural and investment funds. Whether the above policies originated in Brussels, London, or Edinburgh, the end result was a win-win for island communities. And to echo the EU's Global Europe 2050 vision, policies should not be territorially blind. But some things have not changed. In a conference last month, organised by the Shetland Islands Council and the Committee of the Regions, the 2011 Euro Island study was debated and discussed. This study analysed communities across the EU, and the common characteristics were simply this. Islands have below average connectivity, islands have below European GDP average, economic convergence is slower, job and career opportunities are low, with variable quality and high cost of services. But as a counterweight, the 2012 GeoSpec survey concluded that islands had close-knit communities, high-value natural capital, and of course potential for renewable energies, but with higher vulnerability to climate change through heightening sea levels and increased likelihood of storms. So I believe, Presiding Officer, that the time is right for a new Islands Act. Building on best practice from Scotland in the often mentioned today, our islands are future, looking to Europe and looking beyond Europe. And perhaps the best exemplar that I could find for future legislation is the Japanese Island Development Act, which was one of the first in the world to recognise the distinct status of island communities. The Japanese island of Aokahana, with close ties to UHI, became a prefecture based on that, a first level of jurisdiction and an administrative division in Japan. And perhaps the minister in his wind-up, and he has already mentioned this, could perhaps comment on this best practice. But nearer to home, it's worth stressing there's nothing new in the argument about strengthening our island communities. The Montgomery Committee reported in April 1984 and recommended consolidating, developing, and extending the powers of island councils. And of course, one of the key elements of the EU treaty was the principle of subsidiarity, taking decisions in a localised, decentralised way. So what would an islands bill look like? Well, I strongly support, as others have today, the work carried out by the three island councils of Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland, which led to our islands our future. I actually met councillors Angus Campbell and Gary Robinson, the leaders of Western Isles and Shetland, respectively, on Tuesday to discuss their campaign. But new powers need new financial muscle. Real devolution means resource-based control, transferring control of the seabed from Crown Estates to island authorities and onward to the community land and harbour trusts. And new powers need strategic decision-making in the planning, designing and commissioning of mainland to island ferry services. And new powers need recognition of island status in the Scottish constitutional setup. But of course, new powers gained also mean keeping what works well. In the old cliche, if it ain't broke, why fix it? That's why I want to see HIE headquarters remain in the Highlands and Islands with a single high board and one single high chief executive and continued decentralised staff in our island authorities. Now, the bigger picture, presiding officer, is we need active Scottish Government and Westminster Government's commitment to relocate public sector jobs to our island communities. For example, Ofcom jobs to the Western Isles, Marine Scotland to Shetland, the Crown Estates HQ to Orkney as a starter for 10. The consultation on the provisions for the future island bill made interesting reading. There's clear support for the principle of island proofing to fight isolation, remoteness and peripherality, a key tool to empowering the islands. The UK, of course, has adopted the principle of the European Charter for local self-government. We need to act on it. There's also strong support for a national islands plan to provide structure and clarity about setting objectives, monitoring and reviewing. The key will be who is accountable. In conclusion, presiding officer, as I started my speech, I finish by quoting Willie Ross. Again in the 65 debate about the Highlands and Islands, he said, and I'm quoting, "No part of Scotland has been given a shabbier deal by history from the 45 onwards. Too often, there's been only one way out of their troubles for the person born in the Highlands and Islands, and that was immigration. Those who are entrusted with carrying out the duties of the new Islands Bill may find themselves involved with a date with history, themselves part of the history of Scotland. All we need, in the words of Sir Walter Scott, is the will to do and the soul to dare."
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. I call Angus MacDonald, to be followed by Jamie Green. Mr MacDonald, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, can I refer members to my register of interests, and can I say how pleased I am to be taking part in this debate. As a proud Hebridean hailing from just outside Stornoway on the Isle of Lewis, and with my Hebridean genes going back hundreds of years, I care passionately about the islands, their culture, their language and their future. So I was delighted in 2014 to see the Empowering Scotland's Island Communities prospectus agreed by all three island councils, and also the creation of the Scottish Government's dedicated ministerial post as two positive steps forward. The post of Minister for the Islands provides a clear focus for island issues and a voice for all 93 of Scotland's island communities within the government. Of course, our islands have a great deal going for them, but they're never short of challenges to overcome. And one of the most pressing issues is the projected decline in population, particularly in the Western Isles. So it is imperative that finding solutions to the projected population decline facing the islands and the imbalance in age profiles, which sees a rising older population and a decreasing younger one, must be addressed with bold new initiatives. The 2014-based projections predict a severe decline in the population of the Outer Hebrides of 13.7%. The largest percentage projected decline in Scotland. The decline in broad age groups suggests there will be a 28% decline in the 0 to 15 year age group, the largest decline in Scotland, a 21% decline in the working age population, the largest percentage decline along with Inverclyde, and an 11% increase in those of pensionable age. By 2039, the Outer Hebrides is projected to have the second highest percentage of pensionable age and over in Scottish Council areas at 33.2%. And in addition, the Outer Hebrides is projected to have the lowest percentage of children in the 0 to 15 age group at 13.6%. So while that is undoubtedly the most significant long-term challenge, there are of course a number of other shorter-term challenges which must be addressed. The need, of course, as we've heard, the need to provide superfast broadband through schemes such as the Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Scheme in each and every village in the Hebrides is a must, coupled with improved mobile coverage, and the sooner the better. And I was pleased to hear the Minister's commitment to that in his opening statement. It is clear that high-speed broadband could transform small communities the length and breadth of the West Coast and the Northern Isles, relieving them of the reliance on more traditional industries such as crofting and fishing, and widening the horizons to allow a more entrepreneurial spirit to thrive. We could have communities that are thriving, not just barely surviving, and a renewed entrepreneurial spirit would ensure depopulation is reversed. Of course, it needs everyone working together to ensure our island economies flourish. And that's why I was outraged, along with others, when the UK government betrayed the Hebridean communities earlier this month with the shock move to delay a decision on the vital contracts for difference announcement on renewable energy and the knock-on impact that has on the urgently needed interconnector. The prospects of building major wind farms on the islands are now seriously jeopardised if the final outcome is to deny a financial incentive to counter the higher costs of exporting electricity across the Minch. As we know, the UK government previously backed a proposed guarantee payment of £115 per megawatt hour. It's now scrapped the subsidy for onshore turbines, with a possible exception for island-based wind schemes, but such uncertainty, as if we didn't have enough of that, and a further indefinite delay on the contracts for difference and the related plans for a subsea cable to transfer the wind farm electricity to the mainland, which hinge on the present proposed wind farm development going ahead, will have a major impact on the island's economy. The reality, of course, is that renewable energy from the Scottish Islands would be cheaper than offshore. However, the UK government has not chosen the best value for money option and will instead procure the most expensive energy sources. The UK government have completely failed to understand that the islands are the very place which could be the renewable powerhouse for the country. With appropriate investment in grid infrastructure and generating assets, renewable energy in the islands could see economic benefits of up to £725 million, including up to £225 million in community benefits. So the UK government have, of course, the chance to redeem themselves. So let's persevere and hope. Otherwise, we will see a complete betrayal of the people of the Western Isles. There are, of course, many other challenges facing the Western and Northern Isles. You only have to go skip through the Stornoway Gazette, the West Highland Free Press, or the Oban Times to get a flavour of what issues are affecting our West Coast Islands. And I'm sure it's the same with the Shetland Times and the Arcadian. But there are lots of positive developments too. I was lucky enough to be at two major festivals in Stornoway this year, the Hebridean Celtic Festival, or Heb Celts. A coming-of-age event last July generated well over £2 million for the island's economy, and the Royal National Mod in Stornoway in October generated close to £3 million for the island economy over the 9 days that it ran. Presiding Officer, the future is bright for our islands if there is consensus in this chamber, and I was pleased to hear Edward Mountain offer to work together on a number of issues. The forthcoming Islands Bill, the Islands Strategic Group, and the proposals for a National Islands Plan all give me heart for the future. So let's all work together to reduce the challenges our islands face, to ensure lasting benefits for all our island communities for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. MacDonald. I call Jamie Green to be followed by Ivan McKee. Ivan McKee will be the last speaker in the open debate. Mr. Green, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate today. As a member for the West Scotland region, I have the pleasure, along with the constituency and other regional MSPs, to represent a number of islands of notable size and population. The islands of Arran and Great Cumbrae, with a population of around 7,000 people between them, depending on the time of year. Obviously, in the summer period, that swells to a 10-figure sum. But when we think about our island communities, we shouldn't just think about them as places we pop along to with our family on a sunny Saturday summer afternoon. It's important to recognise that they too play a huge part in the Scottish economy, which is why that it is important we support our island communities and recognise that by not being part of the mainland, we may sometimes need to take additional measures to ensure that they are afforded the same standards of living as those of us on the mainland do. If I may, let me take the Isle of Arran. What immediately draws me to Arran is not necessarily always the warmth of its climate, but certainly the warmth of its community spirit and the people. But by its very nature, being an island comes with its fair share of logistical problems. The cost of living is often higher and increasingly becoming unbearable for some. Let me take some examples. The cost of Bringing fuel across from the mainland means that islanders are often paying up to 20 pence more per litre for petrol than, for example, in Ardrossan. But it's not just about filling up your car, it's about keeping warm too. Higher fuel costs mean that 62% of island households have to spend over 10% of their income to keep their houses warm, and a quarter of island households have to spend at least a fifth of their monthly income on heating. So I really hope that the Island Bill will take that particular subject into account. The cost of living is also generally higher. And whilst it's good to see that supermarkets such as the Co-op have invested in Arran, many people still prefer to take their cars to the mainland to stock up on petrol and groceries, and that's despite the added cost of getting there and back. Living on an island also comes with its own issues with regards to healthcare, as my colleague mentioned. A recent surgery on Arran, I met with a retired GP who said that he was genuinely concerned that there is not a pipeline of GPs that want to go and live on our island communities. We know, for example, in the Western Isles, the NHS struggles to fill around 30% of its consultancy vacancies. And in many cases, islanders are forced to make the crossing to the mainland to access medical care. The Chamber will remember it's just a week ago I asked a First Minister question on the issue of waiting times, and a gentleman who was living on Arran had a very significant wait. Much of that was around the difficulty in actually scheduling an appointment that worked around the ferry timetables. Appointments were automatically generated, really not taking into account the physicality of the patients, where they lived, and the logistics of getting to and from the mainland hospital. Which leads me nicely into transport connectivity. Much has been said already on the Ardrossan to ferry service, for the sake of time, I won't repeat too much of that, but I think it's excellent to see that there is genuine cross-party support within this chamber today to keep the terminal in Ardrossan in the long term. I actually did pen a question today for general questions, unfortunately we only made it to question six, but I did ask the government if it had will take into account the negative impact on the economy in Ardrossan if there was a move to Troon. I'm glad to see I did receive a response, and I thank the Minister for this. I've just received it from my office. And it says that the study will look at the economic benefits, public spending, and the needs of ferry users. In this very short response, nowhere does it say it will actually look at the negative impact that such a move would create. Maybe you could respond to it in your summing.
Minister.
I was going to say in your closing statement.
Minister.
Just to say to the member, to give him the reassurance that the socio-economic impact of any ferry change, whatever decision is made, will be part of the stack studies. Just give him that reassurance.
Mr Green.
Thank the Minister for that reassurance. I hope that he will listen to the genuine words from across the chamber from all parties that we are the concerns that we have about this potential move. I'd like to also touch briefly on connectivity. It's an area of great interest to me as the digital economy spokesman in my party, but also through my committee work. I've been meeting a number of organisations to look at innovative ways of how we can reach those difficult and last 5% households in terms of fast broadband. In relation to the issue of mobile coverage, I've met with the leading mobile companies and spoke to them about the difficulties of reaching our rural and island communities. I'm also liaising with DCMS on this, and I welcome the UK government's £1 billion investment into the digital infrastructure announced yesterday. But it's not all doom and gloom. There are some great success stories. Many of them have been named already. Arran Brewery, Arran Aromatics, the distillery, and their fantastic new 14-year malt that came out, Paterson's shortbread, and so on. Just in summary, I hope that this Island Bill really addresses honestly the needs of our islands, and I hope that the government has listened quite hard to this debate today. A number of very excellent points have been raised, but I hope they look more closely at how we help island families with the cost of living and to ensure that we can still bring skilled workers to places like Arran. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Green. Call Ivan McKee, then we move to winding up speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Unlike my city colleague, John Mason, I actually do have an island in my constituency in the middle of Hoggenfield Loch. But my interest in this debate is about the huge potential that islands can contribute to Scotland's economy. Presiding Officer, Scotland is a land of plentiful natural resources, and by far a disproportionate amount of those resources are located on or around our islands. From the Shetlands floating on oil to Isla, home of the malt, and apologies to Speyside, but you can't beat the peat. Orkney, with its vast renewables potential, the beautiful island of Skye, an established tourist destination, but with the potential to grow much more. In fact, a recent poll by Rightmove found that Skye was the most desirable place in the UK to live. Across all 93 of Scotland's inhabited islands, huge potential exists to invest, develop and grow to make their contribution to Scotland's future. In terms of gross value added per capita and the value of exports, many islands contribute far above the Scottish average. And island communities around the world have specific challenges and opportunities. And as often is the case, international comparisons are instructive. The Baltic island of Saaremaa is Estonia's largest, about 1.5 times the size of Skye, with a population of 30,000, three times that of Skye. Saaremaa is connected to the mainland by ferry for most of the year, and I say most of the year because in the winter the Baltic freezes, the ice is thick enough to allow even large vehicles to drive across a makeshift road to the mainland. Twice daily flights from Tallinn provide a faster connection. Saaremaa is a thriving tourist industry, home to several spa hotels, catering to visits from Scandinavia, Germany and Russia, all a short flight away. But my visits to Saaremaa weren't just to enjoy the local hospitality, but because the island also contains several factories, one of the largest of which, employing around 300 people, manufactures of wiring systems that provide the power and communication connections inside commercial jet engines. In fact, every time you take a flight, it's more than likely as Estonian products connecting the engine, and you can give thanks to the good people of Saaremaa for keeping you safe at 30,000 feet. Saaremaa shows that islands can take part in the most advanced technologies, not just those enabled by local natural resources, but can compete and can create value across all sectors. When we talk about our island communities, it's too frequently in conjunction with the challenges they face in terms of connectivity and population decline. But we see what can be achieved elsewhere. We shouldn't set our sights too low when mapping out opportunities for our islands. The island of Egg is an example closer to home, where much progress has been made, importantly driven by local people. After years of instability, neglect and lack of secure tenure, and a groundbreaking move, the Egg Heritage Trust was able to purchase the island in June 1997, ushering in land reform in Scotland, giving islanders control of their future for the first time. The Trust, as their own information makes clear, was established to provide and create opportunity for economic development, housing and infrastructure, while conserving the natural and cultural heritage and ensuring that development takes place in a sustainable way. The Trust has been successful in these aims, with islands now a vibrant and attractive place to live and work, having a growing and forward-thinking population, recognising the importance of Egg's unique identity to its continuing growth and success. The population of Egg is small but growing strongly, a demonstration of the new attractiveness of the island, pointing the way to what can be achieved at community level, not only on our islands but across many of our communities. The Scottish Government has shown its commitment to Scotland's islands, supporting ferry services through a record £1 billion investment in port infrastructure, vessels and services since 2007, the rollout of RET across the Clyde and Hebrides network, and a commitment to reducing fares on ferry services to Orkney and Shetland, a commitment to deliver 100% superfast broadband access by the end of 2021. This is essential to support not only existing businesses and the tourism industry, but the growth of new businesses and to realise the potential for remote working and learning across our island communities. And the Scottish Government is continuing to press the UK Government to deliver a viable package of support to facilitate the vital grid connections to Orkney, Shetland and the Nahil and Nair, as these island groups have the potential to supply up to 5% of total electricity demand to the UK market by 2030. The establishment of the new island strategic group delivers on a key manifesto commitment, building in the work of our islands, our future. The Scottish Government will take forward a new National Islands Plan and an Islands Bill, which will support our island communities in fulfilling their economic potential. All across Scotland, we see opportunities to grow our economy and our population, leveraging our natural and human resources to build a fairer, wealthier and greener society. Our islands have a huge role to play in that, and there's great scope to realise much more of that potential. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call on Tavish Scott to close for Liberal Democrats. Mr Scott, 6 minutes, please.
Gratitude, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start with one plea to us all? Can we stop using that word connectivity? It must be one of the worst words and jargon that any of us use in politics today. Alistair Allen and Liam MacArthur, when we fly home tomorrow morning, it won't be on a connectivity Loganair flight to the islands. It'll be on a connection. So maybe we could drop that one bit of jargon that's become beloved of all politicians of late. Humza Yousaf opened today's proceedings by saying that his heart belonged to Glasgow, although I suspect after this week it certainly doesn't belong to Abellio, so it must be a relief to him to come along this afternoon and talk about islands. And certainly if he's next up in Shetland for the Highland Islands Convention in February, or if not before, he's very welcome to come across to Bressie for tea in a Risted Mutton Bannock at any stage. And I won't take the same cheque as Liam MacArthur demanded out of him for a custard cream in Kirkwall earlier in the summer. Can I just go through the issues that have been raised this afternoon by members across the chamber? And for those who rightly started with transport, that was the thing to do, because for all islands, certainly the islands that I represent, the transport connections are the most important aspect of island life. Now, I welcome the word significant that the Minister used in his opening remarks about ferry fares for the Northern Isles being reduced in line with the West Coast. That's an important step forward, and we will wait to see the detail of that, and I hope he can introduce that once the clarity around the Scottish budget has become clear. I'm going to slightly disagree with him when he says he wants to reintroduce ADS. He's not reintroducing it, because it was already there. Indeed, Stuart Stevenson, when he was the first SNP Transport Minister back in 2007, carried on the scheme that David Stewart mentioned in his opening, remarks earlier on. If the Minister, in his consideration of this issue, can take back the scheme that Stuart Stevenson carried on with, we will all be extremely pleased with that. That would be an important step forward as well for island life.
Mr. Stevenson, you couldn't resist.
I may, of course, be corrected, Presiding Officer, but wasn't the discount 40% in those days, and it's now 50%. So I don't think you want to go back to what I had.
Mr. Scott.
That for businesses, we do, because businesses, of course, don't get any reduction. And what the point we're seeking to make is that we wish to see, as the islands do, the reintroduction of the discount for those categories of passengers as well. There's been some mention briefly of the Crown Estate, and the Minister mentioned it again in his opening remarks, which was important. What the islands want to see is what the Smith Commission agreed. And that was a good piece of work, because it was obviously across all the political parties. I was very pleased to work with John Swinney and Linda Fabiani, the SNP representatives, and indeed Patrick Harvey and other colleagues from the Greens on that. And what, of course, the Smith Commission said on the Crown Estate was, following this transfer for management of Crown Estate assets from the UK to the Scottish Parliament, responsibility for the management of those assets will be further devolved to local authority areas such as Orkney, Shetland and the Western Isles. And I think that's a very important principle that we agreed, and I look forward to the government achieving that. I heard the Minister say there were some legislative obstacles to that. Well, I'm sure a very clever and able Minister such as the one we've now got will get round those legislative obstacles. What I hope is not happening is an internal civil service fight, which I have been told about, over whether this happens as a pilot or what it happens. I know that all of us in the islands are not too bothered about all that internal government stuff, as I'm sure the Minister entirely appreciates. What we want to see is the agreement that for once was agreed on a cross-party basis coming to fruition. There has been less mention this afternoon, although possibly understandably, of our primary industries. I want to just take a minute to mention both fishing and agriculture. The key aspect to the changes that we're going to see, whatever happens with Brexit on fishing, is that the industry want to see the removal of the detested common fisheries policy and instead a Scottish government fisheries policy. I support that. I believe that would be an important step forward. There is a very important point too, of course, about landing more fish and having access to markets. That's a different debate, and we'll have that in many more places over the coming years, I have no doubt. But I would encourage the Minister to work with his colleagues on achieving that and having some initial work done on that very point. On agriculture, the NFU in Shetland will meet tonight with some of the national representatives of that organisation about the light lamb market. That is one of the most pressing issues, not just on my constituency, but I suspect for Alistair Allen's. I know it's a pressing issue for many colleagues in the Highlands and Islands more generally, about market failure, about about the changes to sterling in terms of the impact that has had on marketplace. But the one area of government policy that the minister might seek to address quickly in his wind-up to is on areas of natural constraint. We would look for that policy to be introduced to the advantage of the Highlands and Islands and the islands in particular, given that's what it is absolutely meant to do. The two other points I wanted to make about, we very much support the principles behind the Islands Bill. That's an effective and important step forward, but the Minister will have to deal with the concerns that we all have, the island councils included, about losing powers, for example, about any suggestion of local health boards being lost to a centralised structure. The reason's simple. The island I live on at the moment does not have a community nurse. I am in shall we say, daily communication with the chief executive of our health board to try and sort that out. It's a tricky one because there's a community nursing structure which is having some recruitment challenges, but it's easy for me to do that. If we are simply subsumed into a wider board, then that will become much more difficult. It doesn't matter whether it's me or whether it's the Island Council or whether it's any other representative who is also rightly taking up these important issues. And on high, I don't think there has been some discussion on that. I think the point is very simple on the high board. What the high board does is have a single-minded focus on the Highlands and Islands. Now, whatever may be said, and the Minister may have other arguments that he may wish to deploy, and I understand that, but whatever that super board will have with responsibility for Scottish Enterprise, Skills Development Scotland, the SQA and others, it will not have the same single-minded focus on the Highlands and Islands, and that's what many of us are concerned about. Indeed, many of us in his own party are concerned about it too, possibly not saying it in so many words. And the example that many members have driven this afternoon about, made this afternoon, I apologise, presiding officer, about mobile coverage and broadband is right, is absolutely right. But again, who is doing that? Single-minded focus from high to deliver on that project, which is commendable. It's the right thing to happen. And I hope the minister might bear that in mind when changes are being considered to the high board. Can I commend this debate to Parliament as a useful exercise in raising many of these issues that are important to islands and encourage the government to take forward these issues which matter to many of us and have done for many years. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Scott. I call on Rhoda Grant to close for Labour. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been an interesting debate, sadly highlighting the centralisation of this government rather than their commitment to devolve to islands. And it's true for islands as it is for the rest of Scotland that people should make decisions as close to where they impact as possible. And the government doesn't hold to this principle, as is clearly shown by their actions. So it's hard to believe whether an islands bill or indeed island proofing will have any impact on what the government does to devolve powers. Turning to high, which a lot of members spoke about in the debate, and it's quite clear that there are people that are very concerned about what the government is doing. And one example, I think Donald Cameron mentioned actually at the very start of his speech, was the decision about the Lochaber smelter. That was something that High was involved in. Yes, Fergus Ewing, the Cabinet Secretary, was involved too, but High was there at every meeting with a local focus on what was going on there. And I think if we lose that, we lose everything. David Stewart quoted Willie Ross, who set up HIDB. And I don't think he would have believed that it would be a Scottish government that would actually be dismantling it. And indeed, a very shabby deal that they are doing that. Emma Harper talked about the South of Scotland Enterprise, and I know Colin Smith and other colleagues have fought very hard to have a South of Scotland Enterprise, but if it doesn't have the powers, if it doesn't have the local focus, it won't work. So you're maybe not being sold what you believe because you fought for something like Highlands and Islands Enterprise. What you're getting and what we're getting is something that is absolutely different, because we need a local body of focus in and create wealth throughout our communities, but most especially in islands, which are at a disadvantage. One of the things we had done previously and as part of the Labour-Lib Dem coalition was look at civil service jobs, an issue David Stewart raised today. When we're moving or creating civil service jobs, we should be looking to the remote rural areas and islands to do that. Tyree benefited from getting the crofting housing unit there. Those are jobs that actually underpin that local economy, bringing good paid jobs, and the people don't move because they are qualified, they are educated, so you actually get more for your money in those areas because you get people who are overqualified who simply want a job to live on their islands. Those are things that HIE was at the very centre of, and I would appeal to the government to look again at their decision, because we won't get that kind of focus and support if we don't have something that is based and rooted in our communities. Needless to say, transport and ferries and flights took up quite a bit of this debate. Liam MacArthur asked the minister, and indeed the minister said he was looking at how he would reduce ferry fares to the Northern Isles, but he doesn't have to examine this overly closely or indeed reinvent the wheel, because we all know that the Barra-Oban route does not have RET on it, but yet it benefits from the discount that are enjoyed by the other islands because that route is too far. If they had RET, fares would increase. So there is a way of getting around the RET problem to give affordable fares to islands. And I would suggest that the minister go and look at that, because he doesn't need to look at a whole new system. He just needs to look at replicating that one. A number of members talked about the Arran ferry service and the need to protect that link with Ardrossan, because the alternative is longer journeys, less access to public transport when you arrive, more expensive due to RET and the longer journey. But also one of the things we miss out is things like cultural links, the jobs, the people who work and commute. You change their ferry, that makes life very much more difficult for them. And can I just appeal that the CalMAC board should have islanders on it? People serving our islands, especially for ferries, should actually have on the boards, and the boards are important, as we've talked about before, should have on their boards someone who represents those islands. Talked about their discount scheme and RET, both of which have been removed from businesses. And that's not only taxing the business in that area, but it's also a tax on all islanders. Because if you're taking goods and services into the islands, and indeed those leaving islands to attend health services are being taxed for using using transport. We need to change this, we need to look at it, and I would suggest that the government do this with a sense of urgency to actually free up local economies. Members talked about fuel poverty, access to health services, and indeed Neil Bibby talked about Gaelic and its importance to the culture of our islands in the west, and some of the Argyll Islands too. I think we need to make sure that all those things are taken into account. Broadband especially was one of the things that could be a game changer to our island communities, and they need to be first in the queue, not last in the queue when it comes to services. Presiding officer, empowering our islands is a bit like motherhood and apple pie. Who could possibly disagree? However, the point of empowering is that you hand over powers you hold, and that appears to be a stumbling block for this government. When mainland authorities complain to me that they're being disempowered while islands are being empowered, I ask them to point out to me one power that's being handed to our islands, and that's always greeted by silence because they can't think of one. Therefore, I say to the government, you don't need to wait for a bill to devolve powers. Simply give them the powers they can have now and look at expanding that where you need to through legislation. Actions speak louder than words, so let's see some action.
Thank you very much, Ms Grant. I call Peter Chapman to close with Conservatives. 8 minutes, Mr Chapman.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. You all have noticed that I've had on my lugs this afternoon, and that's the reason is because I was wanting to make sure that I could hear all the debate. My hearing isn't the best, and I blame long days and tractors in my youth as the cause of that. I welcome the consensual approach to this debate today. It is important, I believe, that this Parliament can work together across party lines with an agreed approach whenever that is possible. And I think most speakers have done that today, including the Minister. The number of people on Scotland's islands is relatively small, at just over 100,000, or around 2% of the population. And until I had looked this up, I honestly believed it would have been much more than that. But there we are, that's what it is. And only four islands have a population greater than 10,000, and those four islands make up over 60% of the total island population. But nevertheless, there are over 80 other inhabited islands, and they are all a very important part of our country. Increasing the autonomy for Scotland's island community is a growing political issue, particularly in the spotlight since the 2014 independence referendum. And the fact that we are even looking at an islands bill is a recognition that there are issues unique to this part of Scotland that we must address. And during the debate, we've heard from Rhoda Grant, for instance, that powers devolved need to be real. And Edward Mountain said he calls for more clarity as to what powers are to be devolved. And I echo both of those sentiments. Angus MacDonald spoke about the real problem of population decline, especially in the Western Isles. And of course, it's mostly the young that go away, and you are left with an increasingly aging population. I think that we here today are in broad agreement about the need to ensure that our islands receive as much devolution as possible to help make them more successful. With Scotland on the verge of receiving a swathe of new powers, it is only right that we pass some of those powers onto the islands to allow them to prosper. David Mundell has been quite clear that the regional devolution in England to Cornwall, for instance, and the success of the Northern Powerhouse project both provide clear models for us here in Scotland. There have long been concerns over the centralisation programme undertaken by this SNP government. There seems to be a growing consensus across this chamber that for the islands, a separate solution is needed. And I hope that the upcoming islands devolution is just the beginning of the SNP's realisation that centralisation is not the answer to every question. On health, the health picture for the islands is unfortunately not so positive. And despite some important success stories for the most part, there are serious concerns that need to be addressed. And I believe at the heart of the problems with island healthcare is the significantly higher staff turnover. That's, for instance, 11.5% for Shetland, which is nearly double the Scottish average of 6.4. It's not just the turnover of staff, but also the clear difficulty in filling vacancies, with the Western Isles and Orkney having over three times the percentage of vacancies for consultants, for instance, at about 28%. It should be obvious to everyone that a tailor-made solution and some strategic thinking will be required here. And Jamie Green expanded on this. And we also heard that one of the real dangers that island health boards may be merged, I believe, is the wrong answer. And that was argued well by both Liam MacArthur and Tavish Scott. But that said, presiding officer, it is not all doom and gloom. For those living across Scotland's islands, when it comes to raising kids, the islands enjoy quality education, producing excellent exam results on the back of low primary class sizes, low pupil-to-teacher ratios in secondary schools, all provided by an incredibly high average school spend per pupil. In Orkney, this is double the British average. It's something over £9,000 per pupil. And despite the challenges, many of which we have heard today, that affect islanders, there is a good reason that study after study finds the islands are the best places to live in Scotland. High employment, low crime rates, much less traffic, a real sense of community, and what we can all agree is stunning scenery, all contribute to make islanders some of the happiest people in Scotland. And several speakers mentioned this, in particular Douglas Ross. We've all heard about broadband.
Now, just say, Mr. Chapman, you've made the gentleman from Orkney and Shetland smile.
Did it? Well, I'm delighted about that. It's fine to see them smiling. However, there are other opportunities for the SNP to step up and give some immediate and much-needed support to island communities. Pressing ahead with an expansion of community broadband Scotland should be a priority for this government, and with only 40% of premises in the Western Isles being able to access fibre broadband, and with both Argyll and Bute and Orkney and Shetland local authorities below the 75% mark, it is time for a solution. Yep.
Minister.
The member won't find me disagreeing with the need to increase broadband connectivity, to use a banned word, in the Western Isles. But will he at least acknowledge that the figure that we were dealing with in the islands 3 years ago for fibre broadband was nil?
I do accept Mr. Chapman. And I do accept that work is being done, and I very much welcome that. But there is a real need to move on even quicker. And I do wonder, we have heard that we are going to have 100% broadband coverage at 10 meg by 2021. I do wonder if that's going to be achievable. And it is more important than ever now to see, because most folks see broadband as a right rather than a privilege. And this expectation of a good internet connection in the home and the boost that it can be to businesses and jobs would be a great pull factor to encourage people back to the islands and help reverse the declining population. And of course, the necessity for broadband was mentioned by almost everybody. The cost of living, of course, is likely to always be an issue. It is unavoidable that the cost of transporting groceries to Stornoway will be higher than to get them to Aberdeen. And also, of course, of concern is very much the logistical difficulties. There are a number of companies that will not even deliver to the islands. And even though that number is falling, which is welcome, the surcharges applied have risen by 8% in the last wee while since 2012. Rhoda Grant mentioned that in her speech. And in addition, we have heard about higher energy bills facing island residents. Many of these higher costs come down to infrastructure challenges, with extremely limited access to the national gas grid, for instance. But not only that, a significantly higher proportion of low energy efficiency homes in the islands than the Scottish average. So there's a double hit there. It's got more costly, but your house leaks heat at a higher rate. And this explains why fuel poverty is a bigger problem in the islands than it is in the mainland. And Neil Bibby, Emma Harper and Jamie Green all mentioned this. We also need a cost-effective and efficient ferry service. And there is a difference in the subsidy levels between the Western Isles and the Orkney and Shetland Isles, and this needs to be addressed. Rhoda Grant again mentioned this, and I think Davish and also spoke about it. We also heard a lot today about HIE, and I believe there is an important role for Highlands and Islands Enterprise to play here as well, and I am disappointed that HIE is going to be absorbed into a new national board. I think the Deputy Presiding Officer looking at me with a
yes,
long
because
eye.
Yes, because...
I'm just going to finish there then.
You are indeed with one sentence.
It has, well, maybe two. It
no,
has
with one. Don't take me on.
It has, however, been good to see the Chamber in broad agreement on this matter. I think we all recognise the scale of the challenge that we face in delivering more for the islands, and I hope that is something that we can all work together on to ensure the brightest possible future for our island communities. Thank you.
Either that was two sentences or you don't know how to punctuate. Now I call on Hamza Youssef to close for the Government Minister till 5 o'clock, please.
A brave man, indeed, Presiding Officer. Many interesting and diverse contributions by members across the Chamber. I think Tavish Scott was absolutely correct. A debate like this allows us to air some issues. Of course, there's not going to be 100% agreement on 100% of the issues, but much consensus, I think, on the direction that we have to take. Again, some disagreement over the pace and how that should be done, but certainly a belief here that our island communities greatly contribute to Scotland, and devolution of powers to the island communities is important, and great support from across the chamber for the principles and the broad principles of the Islands Bill as well. In terms of some of the contributions, if I turn to Liberal Democrat contributions, I welcome their support for the commitment to create that Islands Plan, their commitment and their appreciation for the Islands Strategic Group as well. I'll ensure that Liam MacArthur and Tavish Scott are updated regularly on the progress that group makes. In terms of the air discount scheme that was mentioned, Stuart Stevenson was right in his intervention. Of course, this government did increase that discount from 40% to 50%, the maximum that's allowed under the terms. In terms of, there's a difference of interpretation, you're expanding or going back to business travel. My officials tell me it was never meant for business travel, but then, of course, we started to audit it properly, and therefore business travel has been excluded. Now, I know there's a difference in interpretation, but let me just give them the assurance, if I can, to somewhat continue that consensus, that proposal has been put forward by the local authorities involved, and I have promised after have promised to look at it, and he'll understand that there's financial constraints and pressures that we're under, but I have promised to look at it with an open mind. They will be assured, I hope, of the words that I've said in relation to the reduction of ferry fares to Orkney and Shetland. Again, I'll continue to keep them updated on the progress that I can make on that. I was clear to say that what I'm not suggesting is that there'll be an exact match with what's happening in the Western Isles, but what I can say that that the expectation from those living in Orkney and Shetland is that it should be a significant reduction.
Minister, could you speak to the microphone, please?
There should be a significant reduction in those fares, and that's something that I'm exploring and considering. When it comes to that reduction of the ferry fares, there's been a number of discussions that I've already had with stakeholders about this, and of course we had a consultation that they'll know about. Almost 2,000 online responses were received to that consultation, an incredible response. All the responses are now being analysed, and I will review these, and of course I'll inform elected members of my decision on the reduction and the timescales in doing so. But why I can't support the Liberal Democrat amendment is because, of course, it ties us in to a specific timescale. He'll understand, and the members will understand, that I have to consider those 2,000 responses carefully. And as I said, I'll keep them updated on what we're going to do. In terms of the other points that were made by Liberal Democrats on Health Board, I refer them to a letter from Shona Robinson. They received that response. What we're doing in terms of reorganisation of the health boards is being done, that the only driver behind that is to improve patient care. And I think they both made their points very well. And the whole point of island proofing is not just about legislation, but I should say also policies of our government as well. And so we wouldn't be taking forward island proofing to put forward policies that would damage the island. So I hope that gives them some kind of reassurances. I thought the points were well made. Also by Liam MacArthur in particular about fuel poverty, if I may just make progress, fuel poverty in particular. And again, I can furnish him with many of the details of what we're doing to address that, but he's right to say Orkney has a particular problem. And I thought his points were well made on housing insulation and regulations as well. In terms of the Crown Estate, which Andy Whiteman had mentioned, I have to say I haven't yet figured out the answer to his riddle, and I will furiously go back and Google it when I have the chances to do so. But on the Crown Estate, I do refer him to our manifesto, a commitment about island communities receiving the full revenues from the Crown Estate assets around their shores and having a greater say in how the assets of a Crown Estate are managed. And I also bear in mind what has been agreed in the Smith Commission as well. So when it comes to the pilot that has been proposed by the three Holland Island Councils, I'm entering into very constructive discussions with them, and I'm having those constructive discussions with my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary, for the environment as well. If I can turn to Rhoda Grant's contribution and Labour contributions that were made, I can say there's much in the Labour amendment that we could agree with. I want to give some reassurances if I could. Firstly, that I accept that more has to be done. I'm not saying that we've made progress and that's the end of it, and the Islands Bill will be the end of it. There always has to be progress. I think that's absolutely correct, and I want to give her that reassurance. She was absolutely right that island communities should be more involved in decision-making on transport links, and I can assure her that we are doing that, as evidenced by the consultation that we've taken forward on ferry fares and the reduction of those ferry fares to the Northern Islands, and also for what we're doing in terms of the Ardrossan to Brodick service, and in terms of the proposal that has come forward from Troon that has been mentioned by a number of members here. The consultation, the Stag-style appraisal that we're taking forward will allow communities to directly input into what service they want to see. The reason why I can't accept Labour's amendment would be the same reason that I can't accept the Conservative amendment when it comes to what they're saying about Highlands and Islands Enterprise. Yes, I entirely agree that Highlands and Islands Enterprise has done some great work. We have partnered them, we have funded them, we have supported them in that work as well. And let's not forget that without this government's funding, alongside with HIE, there would be no fibre broadband anywhere in Scotland. The point is, we have committed to retain Highlands and Islands Enterprise. That is the very point. My colleague, the Cabinet Secretary, Keith Brown, has started phase two. Let me just finish and make this point if I can. Has had that discussion on phase two, which will look at the board moving forward, and the representatives, the chairs, including of HIE, the chairs of the agencies, were at that meeting about phase two. So what we want to do is have streamlining. What we want to do is have alignment across Scotland. Why should Skills Development Scotland not benefit from the great expertise of Highlands and Islands Enterprise? Of course it should. So this is what people want to see on the ground is local service delivery. That will be maintained. And as I said, there will be alignment in that board. But of course, I'll give way to
Rudy Grant.
Does he not believe that the board has influence, that a board grounded and rooted in its community will bring forward proposals and indeed actions that benefit that local community? I mean, he has often said, you know, he comes from Glasgow, he is not an expert. Well, can I tell him that people who come from out with the Highlands and Islands will not be experts? We need people local with the expertise making the decisions that affect us.
Minister.
Phase two that we're taking forward of the review will engage with agencies and their existing boards and draw on that advice from other experts in developing and consulting on the detailed scope of the functions for that new statutory board. So, look, we have and we are listening. We're taking forward this review, including to bringing forward the chairs of the various enterprise agencies to inform that. But what matters to businesses on the ground is the local delivery, and that local delivery will absolutely be maintained. And the reason why I can't accept the Conservatives' amendment is for that very purpose. I mean, I am finding it hard to swallow that the Conservatives care what happens to HIE when all of the work that is supported is threatened by Brexit. You know, all of the jobs, the businesses, the projects that are supported by HIE, that is absolutely affected by that. And the biggest threat they face is through Brexit. So I and this government are totally committed to supporting and strengthening Scotland's Isles. We have an ambitious programme of action to create a lasting and enduring framework which will support and act as a catalyst to ensure the continued well-being of our island communities. We'll work with all local interests, particularly the Island Strategic Group, where we have to. We will always listen, do our best to act. Yes, there's been many issues raised here by members across the chamber when it comes to the Islands Bill, and we'll look to incorporate that. When it comes to phase two and the review of the enterprise agencies. And there's been many other issues that have been discussed which we'll reflect on. And I will look forward to working with members across the chamber when we bring forward this islands bill, which will be a historic island bill. And the communities on our islands deserve no better than us working together, working collaboratively where we can to strengthen local democracy for those who live in our islands. And I'm pleased to move the motion in my name, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Before we conclude, I just ask Mr. Whiteman whether he's going to give the Chamber the answer to his riddle that he asked earlier.
Presiding Officer, the answer is actually in Marie Todd's constituency.
It was indeed.
In fact, it's in the Lough that she's named after on one of the islands, Lough Maree.
Lough Maree. Thank you. And that concludes our debate on supporting and strengthening Scotland's communities. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 2686.2 in the name of Donald Cameron, which seeks to amend Motion 2686 in the name of Hamza Youssef on supporting and strengthening Scotland's island communities, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 2686.2 in the name of Donald Cameron is yes 53, no 62. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 2686.4 in the name of Rhoda Grant, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Hamza Youssef, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. Thank you. The result of the vote on the amendment from Rhoda Grant is yes 53, no 61. There was one abstention and the amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 2686.1 in the name of Liam MacArthur, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Hamza Youssef, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed again. We shall move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on the amendment in the name of Liam MacArthur is yes 26, no 62. There were 28 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The final question is that motion 2686 in the name of Hamza Youssef on supporting and strengthening Scotland's island communities be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. And that concludes decision time. I close this meeting of Parliament.